Good evening, everyone. This coming Shabbat, we're going to start the new Sefer, new book, Exodus, Shmot. Before we get to speak about the new book, I still want to say a few more words about the ending of Sefer Bereshit, Genesis, and speaking about some of the things that happened this week in the world, as usual. And last week, which was a very popular lecture, I don't know, sometimes it's hard to explain why some lectures do double or triple than others. It has a lot to do with the naming. People have X amount of time, they go by the name. They like the name, they listen. If not, ברוך מחיה מתים, איזה הפתעה.
חיינו וקיימנו וגענו בזמן הזה.
אה, צדיק מאיר. וואלה, nice surprise. אה, ברוך השם. אוקיי, now I'm in a good mood. So we'll start again. Good evening. Good evening. It's been a long time since I got a kiss. So we're going to speak now, Bezrat Hashem, about the end of Sefer Bereshit, beginning of Sefer Shmot. Last week, the lecture did amazing. Maybe people like some of the explanations we did over there. Whatever. Hopefully this one will also do very good. I spoke about real zealousy. If you're zealous to Hashem, is it really for Hashem? And we prove that the greatest people in the history, no matter how zealous they were, it was still not 100% pure. What are we going to say about ourselves? Sometimes we are convinced we're doing it for the sake of heaven, but if we really, really will be able to analyze our mind and subconscious, we would see that it's not only for Hashem, it's also for Hashem, but not only. That's why no one is allowed to be zealous today. Zealous means you can take a Jew that is with a Goya and kill him on the spot. And not only you don't get punished, you get a reward for it. No one can do it. The Gemara already 2,000 years ago said that no one can do it. So the idea is that we analyze this very well. Today, I have one more thing left that I didn't have time last week to talk about. I spoke about it yesterday in Queens, but this is something different. Yaakov is basically criticizing Shimon and Levi for their anger and for being impulsive and for killing all these goyim without consulting with him first. Why don't you ask? Why you run to do things? Why can't you control your anger? And he basically gives them a curse that is the best blessing they could have got. That's what my whole lecture was yesterday. Very interesting. This whole thing, how it affects even people that are in Leviim and Kohanim, even today. The words of Yaakov 3,300 years ago. But sometimes you actually curse a person out of love. I know it sounds crazy, but it's really out of love. For instance, if you know you have a son that is a drug addict, so you wish him that he should never have money. I bless you that you should never have a penny in your pocket. Is this a curse or a blessing? At this situation right now, it's the best blessing you can give him. Because as soon as he gets money, he runs and injects heroin into his veins and dies. How many kids died already? So you don't want him to die, so you curse him that he should not have money. If he was normal, first thing you do, give him a blessing to have money. If you have a kid that every time he has money in his pocket, he runs to Manhattan to make scenes. So by him wishing him that he should never have money, that's a curse or a blessing? Blessing. If you have a friend that all he does is make scenes with the women, and he can never stop, 20 years people try, you try to teach him Torah, you try to threaten him, you show him what's going to be his end, nothing helps. He continue every week to do the same sins. So if you bless him that he should be unable to have It's a curse. You curse him that he should not be able to have any relation with any woman anymore, meaning physically. I give you this. I wish you that you should never be able to be with a woman ever again. That's he's 50 years old, and you give him this curse. This is a curse or a blessing? You want to give him a chance not to have Olam Haba. Otherwise, he's done. That's it. A person like this. At least now he cannot do it. He has time to do tshuva. Remember this. One of the main reasons why all of us make sins is not because we hate God, God forbid. Even the goyim don't hate him. So we definitely don't hate him. It's not that we don't respect him. It's not that we are naturally ungrateful. It's not always because we are ignorant. Most of the time it's ignorance. But even those who are not ignorant make sins. So why would we go against the one that we owe him everything? Why? Isn't it the minimum decency to listen to him and obey his rules? Everybody knows that. So why we still make sins? So I know what you're going to say. Oh, we have Yetzer Hara, evil inclination, all this. Yetzer Hara, we also have Yetzer Hara to kill someone who stole all our money, but we're afraid. We're not doing it. Why? Because we know we're going to pay the price. So why would Hashem not worry about paying the price? So the answer is, once a person is eating bribe, he cannot see reality. Remember this. When you receive bribe, the Torah says, "Hashochar ye'aver enei chachamim v'yisalef divrei tzadikim." The shochad makes the eyes of the righteous and the chachamim and the scholars, it makes their eyes blind. The Torah didn't say that because you receive bribe, you feel uncomfortable to go against the person that pays you under the table. That's not what the Torah say. The Torah said that the bribe actually penetrates into your brain, into your conscience, into your subconscious, and twists everything to the other side, meaning that you're willing to hold now the Torah or to be connected to a lie detector and swear that what you do, it's not only a sin, it's a mitzvah. And I'm sure Hashem is happy from what I'm doing. And if I connect you to a lie detector, the machine will show that you really believe in it. How many Jews marry Goyot and they are 100% sure that they did actually a mitzvah? Going later on, converting them, or doing all kinds of things. And when they come to the rabbi, it's the best thing I ever did. She's so great. She's so righteous. Thanks to her, I'm this. Thanks to her, I'm that. Bottom line, you made a horrible crime. Who are you telling stories? Now, let's try to save from your crime whatever we can. Who are you telling stories? No, but you connect him to a lie detector. He actually, the machine shows that he believes he did a mitzvah. Why is it? Because he received bribe from her. Sexual bribe. That's it. He cannot see the Torah, he cannot see the rabbi, he cannot listen. Everyone that talks to him, he thinks they're all crazy. Same thing a person that takes drugs. Once he takes drugs and he needs the drugs, he'll sell his mother for $2. Let her die if he needs, for the next time he needs. He doesn't care about anyone. But he doesn't know that he has to respect your parents. He doesn't know that it's your parents? Of course he knows. But how many drug addicts kill their actual parents for drugs with guns or rob their house or stole all their money or charge the credit card in the whole world and got them into to lose their house? They did it because they hate their parents? No, of course not. They did it because they believe that what they do is right? No, of course not. The bribe, that 5 minutes pleasure that they have or an hour, whatever it is, got them to lose their mind. Why is it? The bribe blinds your eyes. Now what happened to these drug addicts? Once they already do it, they comfort themselves. My father deserves it. He's not such a great person. I saw in my own eyes a kid under heroin influence. What things he said to his father? He made him like Hitler. And his father was a saint. You know what a saint? Kadosh. The best father you can have. But once he came out of the drugs, he's crazy about his father. He's the best. I wish everyone to have such father. What changed? Nothing changed in reality. Once he was eating bribe, it drives him crazy. Pride drives people out of their mind and they cannot see the truth. That's why every one of us, if you have addiction to food, food, non-kosher food, you eat it, you're going to find 50 different permissions by the rabbi. Oh, that rabbi allow it, this one. Women love wigs. They don't like to cover their head, most women. They'll fight for a year to prove that there's no problem with the wigs. Why is it? They eat bribe. When she puts the wig, she gets compliment. That's bribe. Once you get compliment, you enjoy the compliment, you enjoy the attention. Man is complimenting you, looking at you in the street. It helps you to build your confidence. The Satan is pumping into your Yetzer Hara even more and more poison. And then you lose your Olam Haba. What do you think? That's a whole system. So today, let's focus on something different. What is it? It's like this. We have a rule, we say that hundreds of times, I'm sure you heard it many times, even for me alone. What is it? Ezehu hagibor in Pirkei Avot. Chazal are asking a question. How do you define a hero? Who is a hero? Someone with muscles? Someone that ran the marathon? An Israeli commando soldier? Shimshon HaGibor that knocked down 3,000 Philistines when he died? Who is a hero? A doctor that worked day and night to save people in a time of the war? An ambulance driver? A sergeant? A rabbi? A teacher? Donald Trump? Who is a hero? There could be thousands of different kinds of heroes. The Gemara says, forget about it. There's only one hero. Who is a hero? HaKovesh Et Yitzro. Someone that can win the war against his evil inclination, against his desires. No modesty, desire for food, desire for money, desire for honor, desire to make it, stinginess, laziness, sport, women, jewelry, luxury, all these desires. By the way, drugs is not only heroin and cocaine. There are thousands of different drugs. Mercedes is a drug. Bentley is a drug. For some people, Toyota is a drug. Everything that you will sell your soul for, it's a drug. Women is drugs. Jewelry is drugs. High heels is drugs, perfume is drugs, makeup is drugs, the wigs is drugs. There's so many different kinds of drugs. Nice clothing is drugs, expensive watches is drugs. There are millions of drugs. Everyone has desire for different drug. Some drug addicts, they like heroin. The other ones like cocaine. The other ones like only to smoke grass. But there's other drugs. Those are drugs that apparently can kill you right away. If you're addicted to heroin, you die. In a few months, you're dead. We know it. We see the consequences of it. Some drugs don't kill you, but they kill your Olam Haba. Women. People that go out with women, make scenes, these, goyo, Jews, married women, they don't die. Still running, jogging, making money, driving a fancy car. Sometimes it looks healthier than 5 years ago. What is your secret? You understand? But he lost his Olam Haba. So this drug took away his Olam Haba. Some drugs take away Olam Haba. It's worse than Olam Hazeh. Some drugs only take Olam Hazeh. Some drugs take Olam Hazeh and Olam Haba. The next world as well. So the Gemara says, Ezehu hagibor hakovesh et yitzro. Now I'm going to teach you something about Birkat HaMazon, then you understand the connection. The most important tefillah and prayer and blessing in a Jewish religion is the blessing of the food, when you eat bread. You sit, you wash your hands, you made bracha, motzi lechem min haaretz, you ate bread, you ate at least 1 ounce of bread, meaning that you feel a little bit full now already. That's it. You're already obligated to say Birkat HaMazon. From the Torah, you need 2 ounces. But the Rabbanan made it already 1 ounce, 28 grams. from rabbinical, you already have to say, what's 28 grams? Like a fist, a piece like this. That's it, 1 ounce of bread. Half a pita bread, something like that. From the Torah, 2 ounces, a whole pita, fine. That's it. When we eat bread, that's what we eat. We don't eat less than it.
One slice
of pizza, it's already enough. It's already over there, you have 56 grams of dough. Yes, yes, yes. Unless if it's made with apple juice or milk that you see that when you press on the crust, it becomes right away powder, like a powder, then you know it's not really bread. It's like a cracker. You understand? Or if they do the dough with lots of oil. Rabbi Zion Abba Shaul, he writes about it in Or Letzion. But most of the pizzas that you have today, it's Birkat HaMotzi. Some Ashkenazim say if you eat 2 slices and up, yes. By us, the Sfaradim, no question. 1 slice, even the crust of it, those puffy crust, it's already 2 ounces. And it's total bread, ma. If I give it to you without knowing it's a crust, you would eat it, you would. It's 100% bread. What's the question? Some people, they are so foolish, I don't want to say stupid, but foolish for sure, that they will go to look for bread that it's not hamotzi. Nobody is dumber than these people, and soon you're going to understand why. Because once you do Birkat HaMazon, it's even more important than Tfilat Shmona Esrei that you pray in Yom Kippur. Because all the prayers that we pray, it's all rabbinical. Tfilat Shmona Esrei, the Rabbanan. Everything Rabbanan. The only prayer that it's a direct obligation from God Himself, it's Birkat HaMazon. It's written in the Torah. ואכלת ושבעת וברכת את השם אלוקיך. You should be eating and you'll be full and then you bless your God for the food that he gave you and for the land. Now let's learn something about Birkat HaMazon. Listen carefully. Birkat HaMazon, mitzvah deoraita. It's mitzvah from the Torah that is actually having 3 blessings. And then the rabbi has added 1 more blessing. The 4th blessing is rabbinical, meaning until you get Baruch Atah Hashem Bonei Yerushalayim, up to here it's all the Oraita. From now on, it's rabbinical edition, which is very important. You cannot stop right here. You have to finish until the end. But the Chachamim were so smart that while they added the 4th bracha, they actually added all the necessary thing to a human being in his life. Since we already have an obligation from the Torah to bless God and to thank him for what he gave us, let's attach to it everything we need. Because now it's a very high level of blessing. Very high level. Let's attach. Like I give you an example. If you have a lot of meetings during the year in business, but only once in a blue moon you meet the top president of the company, and you have important necessities in a business, you need permit here, you need a special loan there, you need a discount over here, you keep the most important thing to the one meeting that you have every once in a while. You don't speak to every fool on the street, help me with this, help me. You know they cannot do basically anything. So when you finally have an opportunity to meet the big boss, what do you do? Now, like the Israeli prime minister, when he meets politicians in America, ambassador, this, that, congressman, okay, see what you can do for us. But when he finally meets the president, he comes with a really important list. Why is it? Because that's the way the world is. Now when we finally have Birkat HaMazon, the Chachamim say, now it's an opportunity to push everything you need. Oh, let me read to you what it says. It says like this. The Gemara says, Kol shelo amar eretz chemda tova uchava brit v'tora bebracha shniya ומלכות בית דוד בברכה רביעית לא יצא לידי חובתו. First ברכה is, ברוך אתה השם, אזן את הכל. That's for the man that came. We made ברכה. Thank you, Hashem, for feeding everybody. Okay. Next bracha is על הארץ ועל המזון. Now when we enter Eretz Israel, until now we were in the desert. So there's only one bracha. What? For the man that we eat. What bracha they made when they ate the man? Hamotzi lechem min ha-shamayim. Not min ha-aretz. Min ha-shamayim. The bread is coming from heaven. Okay. Then they fool, they eat, they make bracha, hazan et hakol. After that, when Yoshua ben Nun entered Israel, he added one more bracha. What? Now we have to bless Hashem al ha-aretz. He gave us the land. He kept his promise. Very good. Then David HaMelech prepared the foundation for Bet HaMikdash and his son Shlomo made Bet HaMikdash. Now we have finally, we came to this dream. They added Bonei Yerushalayim. Because when you say Bonei Yerushalayim, it's not like you see Jerusalem became the most prestige city in the world, really state-wise. Beautiful, fancy building, $30 million homes, fanciest hotels in the world. That's not Bonei Yerushalayim, like some people think. Bonei Yerushalayim means that we have Bet HaMikdash and religious kingdom. We still don't have today Bonei Yerushalayim. What do we pray every morning? Every day we pray the same bracha that was made after the destruction of the temple. Why? We're back in Yerushalayim. Even the president gave us a stamp that Jerusalem belongs to us. So maybe we should change the bracha. No, nothing has changed. Even now you have your million Jews live in Jerusalem and you have million homes and whatever you have and highways and yeshivot and the Western Wall is in our hand and all that, it's still not Bonei Yerushalayim. Bonei Yerushalayim means when you have Bet HaMikdash that Hashem comes to live among us. Right now there's only Shechina in the Kotel HaMaravi, but it's not in the same level like it was in Bet HaMikdash. Top. Huh? No, that's the Bonei. After they came, then they built the first Bet HaMikdash, they added, Baruch Atah Hashem, Bonei Yerushalayim. After that, it's written in a Siddur that you have to say Amen quietly. Why? Why you have to say Amen quietly? Usually when you say Amen, you have to say loud, not to be embarrassed. Amen! Right? If you say Amen on Kaddish, you even have to raise your voice. Amen, Yesh Merabah. Not like, me. You know, some shuls you come, you sit there half an hour, you don't hear a word. Even the chazan go up. Few words you say, barely hear anything. People go up to the Torah, you don't hear anything. The one who reads in the Torah, you barely hear anything. It's mamash, people decided not to make, maybe they wake up the neighbors, I don't know. They're very worried. One chassid came to a Litvi shul, and you know, started like this, with this peot, flying all over, screaming. All the lawyers and the doctors over there, they pray very quiet. They don't want to disturb anyone. But this chassid doesn't belong here. Shh! Ah! Ana Hashem Hoshiana! Then one of the politically correct say to him, excuse me, don't you see that you disturb everyone? With your loud voice. Can you keep it quiet, please? What the Hasid did, gave him such a smack, pah, to his face like this. And this doctor, he started to scream, "Ay!" So the Hasid said, "Why are you screaming? Why did you just scream? What? You hurt me." So you see, when it hurts, you scream. You understand? You're good, you're all of you good. Lawyer, doctor, judges, making millions, 300 customers on waiting list, you book 6 months in advance, come to the office. Yes, Nir, you put your outfit, everything working for you, 15 girls working for you, doctor, this, that. I, tomorrow, have to pay the rent. If not, the marshal is throwing me in the street with 11 kids. I scream. You don't have to scream. You understand? When it hurts, you scream. When you're good, you pray like this. No problem. Like you came to the library. There is praying and there is praying. Even ask when things is good, we're not putting so much in a prayer. Oh Hashem, let it stay like this. when things begin to go down, you see how people change their treatment to the davening, to the prayers. Right away, if somebody's sick in the family, lo aleinu. Right away, there's a sharp elevation in the level of the prayers. The brothers, the sisters, the neighbors, everyone woke up. Why didn't you wake up before? The idea is to do it before the problem comes, not after it came. Once it comes, it's much harder to cancel it. I told you once a story that one guy came out of the shul and he crossed the street and a car hit him. He broke his legs. A few weeks later, he came back to the shul. Baruch Hashem is walking. It's a miracle. So he made a meal in the shul after the prayers to thank Hashem for all the for the great miracle that he did to him. So he made a very nice meal. He said nice thank you words to Hashem. And right after that, the next day, another person from the shul also made a special meal to thank Hashem. So they say to him, hey, what happened to you? You also got hit by a car? He said, no, Baruch Hashem, never. For 20 years I pray in this shul. Every day I cross the street in the same place this guy crossed the street and got hit by a car. For 20 years a car never hit me, even though it's a very dangerous highway here. Why should I wake up only after I get hurt and get saved to say thank you to Hashem? I want to already say thank you before I get hit by a car. But I should never get hit by a car. That's a very important lesson for life. Pray to Hashem and say every minute, thank you for breathing, for being healthy, for walking, for able to see, to hear, to understand. My brain, my memory is functioning. I'm able to have money, to have food, to eat, to go to the bathroom normally. I don't have to go to doctors every other day. For that, you have to say thank you every day. What are you taking it for granted? You take it for granted. You have a car. Do you know how many people in the world dream to have the worst car that you can imagine? They can never afford to buy a car? Go to India, ask how many people own a car. And what cars they have? Cars that you wouldn't agree to sit there a minute. From the 60s. You know, when as soon as you started, the whole neighborhood is black smoke. What do you think? How many people, whatever we have, we take for granted. Even a tie. Some people cannot even afford to buy a tie. What do you think? Nothing. Some, Rav Ovadia Yosef, when he was young, didn't have money for buses. Read in their books, him and Rav Benzion Abba Shaul will walk an hour walking every day. Why? Because Rav Ovadia had money for the bus back and forth, but Rav Benzion was so poor, they couldn't afford the bus. And the buses in Israel are subsidized by the government, meaning 80% of the cost, the government pay. Meaning it's very, very cheap. $1 a ride or $2, that's it. Today, back then it was even cheaper. And even that he couldn't afford. So Rav Ovadia would pay for both of them one way. And then on the way back, they walked and learned Gemara the entire hour. So like this, first I do chesed to my friend, that he doesn't have to walk an hour back and an hour forth. And we drive together with the bus, learning on the bus. And we walk together on the way. But even people couldn't afford the bus. In one of the pages, it says that there was no money for food when the Jordanians used to shoot missiles on Yerushalayim. For 3 days, everyone said to learn Torah with no food. 3 days, no food. Not one day. 3 days, nothing to eat. Now one piece of bread. He said that the entire yeshiva, the stomachs of the people were grinding so hard that you could hear it from all over. That's how loud it was. We, the worst case scenario, we don't eat 6-7 hours, we already feel the stomach is grinding. 10 hours, you're already dizzy. Imagine 3 days what the stomach would do. No food, no nothing. That's how much they love the Torah, that in this condition, we're still learning full day, like everything is usual. So, why do we say Amen on the third bracha of Birkat Hamazon quietly? Because the Chachamim 2,000 years ago they already knew that they are ignorant Jews. And ignorance make you wicked. Ignorance is one of the reasons that a person become wicked. Because he doesn't learn, and he doesn't care, and he doesn't have Yirat Shamayim, and his Yetzer Hara is very strong because he doesn't learn. He makes a lot of sins. So what's the way of the ignorant? As soon as they hear that this mitzvah is rabbinical, they kick it right away. Ah, it's not from the Torah. The rabbis made it. What rabbis? Each one of them could revive you from the grave. What do you mean rabbis made it? It's not rabbis like today. It's the every one of these chazal was greater than an angel. Everything in the Torah they knew, the level of their holiness is beyond words can tell. What do you think? It's little students in yeshiva like today? But right away, just tell me what the Torah say. I don't want to hear what Chazal say. That's the apikorsim. So if you say amen, if you say it loud, the ignorant will understand that Birkat Amazon finished here. They won't say the rest. Because amen usually finished. You have to say amen because until now it was the Oraita from the Torah. From now on, it's addition of the rabbis, rabbinical. So, if you say amen loud, most of the ignorant people, they close the siddur right away and go. For another minute to say thank you to Hashem. But the idea is that who is losing by making Birkat Amazon shorter? The person. Because all the requests come right after Bonei Yerushalayim. Vinu malkenu dazunenu parsenu kalkelenu, and then all arachman ishtabach al kiser vodo arachman ishtabach, all these requests, give us this and give us this, and everything is the last bracha. For that you should wait, and oh, Baruch Hashem Berkat Amazon, I have a chance now to ask from Hashem everything. So now we have to understand one thing. Rashi says, בזכות התורה והמצוות ירשו את הארץ, שנאמר למען תחיון. You learn Torah, you're going to live in the land that I'm going to give you. And we also have to say the word Brit in Birkat Amazon, covenant. Why? If we keep the Brit, Brit Mila, we have the merit to sit in the Holy Land. If not, we cannot sit in the Holy Land. You must have mitzvah brit milah to sit in the Holy Land. That's the connection. Connection to the Holy Land, brit milah. Yehoshua, before he entered the Jewish nation to Israel, after 40 years they were in the desert, he circumcised everyone just before. Why they did not circumcise their children for 40 years? Because you cannot circumcise a baby in a desert. There's wind and sand. It's not a place that, you know, to make a surgery. People can die from it. You have to have a clean place and your person has to be protected. So since there's a life risk, that's the same thing with Moshe and his sons. He could, while he was on a move in a desert with the donkeys, he cannot make Brit Milah. It's not the right condition for Brit Mila. As soon as they came to the hotel, that's when Hashem got angry at him. Okay, until now, you had an excuse because you couldn't do it. But now when you came to the hotel, why are you waiting an extra hour? Moshe almost died for it. Tzipora ran quickly to do Brit Mila. Tzipora, his wife. Meaning you see clearly that until now there was no anger at Moshe. When the anger started, when he arrived to the hotel. Because now you can do Brit Milah. You're in a building, you're in a place that it's safe. So now, Yehoshua had to circumcise all of them because without it you cannot inherit the land. But we have to ask one question. Why do we have to mention Malchut Bet David in Birkat Amazon? We must say the kingdom of David. What does it have to do with blessing Hashem for the food? The answer is, Rabotai, Chazal say, Malchut Bet David got one punishment from Hashem, that they will be divided to two. David HaMelech heard Lashon Hara, and he did not protest, and Hashem said to him, the same way Lashon Hara makes fight and split between two, your kingdom will be split to two. Kingdom in Israel and kingdom in Jerusalem. Yerovam and Rechavam. Yerovam is in the rest of Israel and Rechavam is in Jerusalem. Two kings at the same time. It's like having two prime ministers now in Israel. Imagine this. Whoever follow me, come to me. Whoever follow him, go. What do you mean? We need one president. Imagine two presidents of the United States. President on 20 states is this guy. President on 31 states is this guy. It's crazy. Can I have two bosses? But that's what happened. It's a punishment. ביום שנחלק בית דוד, כפרו בגימל דברים. They were rebelling against three things. בקדוש ברוך הוא, and against Hashem, against בית המקדש, and against מלכות בית דוד. Three things. ואין יגלים עד שיתוודו ויתבעו את שלושתם. You won't have salvation until you fix these three sins. Rebelling against God, rebelling against the temple, and rebelling against the kingdom of Bet David, meaning Mashiach. So you want to repent? A part of repentance is to do confession. We do it. Every day we do. And demanding, I want it, please. I was stupid to lose it or not to pay respect to it. Now I want you to give me another chance. This is demanding, like a son that comes to his father. I know you kicked me out of the house because I was disrespectful and I rebel against you, but I want you to let me in that this time I can prove to you I deserve it. That's the idea. So first you apologize. Chatati, aviti, I'm sorry, it's my fault. I take full responsibility and I really want it. You have to show that you really want it. I want my job back. No, you can't have it. No, please, I'm sorry. I was so stupid. It's my fault. I will never do the same mistake. Oh, so the boss see that, oh, finally you understand. So you're willing to confess. But that's not enough. I want to prove that you really want the job. Show me a proof. Okay, so that's a part of doing tshuva. Because of that, we have to also mention the kingdom of heaven, which is Hashem. Even though it's not worthy, listen to this, לא ראוי להזכיר מלכות שמיים אצל מלכות בשר ודם. When you speak about a king of flesh, like David המלך, or Shlomo, or all the other kings, you don't want in the same paragraph to also speaking about the real king. You're mixing a king that is a human being and a king of the world in the same paragraph. It's not so much respect, but over here, because it's so necessary, they allowed to do such a thing. Tov. We will not have a full, complete comfort until the kingdom of David will come right back into its place, meaning that the temple will be rebuilt for the third time. We still have to ask, why Chazal, in Masechet Brachot, page 48, when they speak about the subject, why they say if someone did not mention Bet HaMikdash in Birkat HaMazon, it's like he did not make the bracha. Okay, I want Bet HaMikdash. We want Bet HaMikdash. Even though we don't have any idea what Bet HaMikdash is. People that didn't learn a few years in yeshiva, they don't know what Bet HaMikdash is. Ask any religious businessman. Tell me, why we need Bet HaMikdash? What's so special about what's going to happen when Bet HaMikdash will come back? Nobody knows. Even Talmid Chachamim don't know everything. Because some questions are problematic. I'll give you an example. If there will be Bet HaMikdash, what kind of sacrifice we will have to do? Will we still have to do regular sacrifices of holidays and this and that, like it used to be? Or that's already history. What sacrifice? For 2,000 years we're praying now. Well, you want us to start slaughtering? All kinds of questions like this. If we're not going to have Yetzer Hara, that means we won't have any sins. would we have to bring korbanot that comes because of sins, sacrifices of sins, if we don't have sins? Maybe yes. Maybe for unintentional sins that do not come from Yetzer Hara, come from accidents, right? If by mistake you turn the lights on Shabbat, that's not because you want to go against Hashem, or that's not because you cannot live without light. You just forgot it's Shabbat. Or you didn't realize that Shabbat started 2 minutes ago. You thought it starts in 10 minutes. So you set up the light 2 minutes in Shabbat already. Wow! I didn't know it's Shabbat. Now you have to bring Korban Chatat. What? I accidentally broke Shabbat. Would you have to do it in the time of Bet HaMikdash? Why not? In the time of Bet HaMikdash, they used to bring, for not intentional sins, they used to bring a sacrifice. Imagine, it's going to be a whole different world. How are you going to bring the goat in your nice Dodge truck? You come with air condition, nice music, Hasidic music. Pop. Rabbi Cohen, put me on the list. What? Accidentally, I turned the light on. I bought a nice fat goat here, you know, sheep. You know, try to imagine how it's going to be. A person comes, nice suit, tie, comes like this with his jewelry, and his wife comes with her heels. Marty, wait a minute, I want to see how you do tshuva. That is slaughtering. Chatati, aviti, pashati. Is it going to be in a time of Mashiach? It's a lot of questions we have to understand. Not every answer is unanimous. Some machlokot, what's going to be, how it's going to be, tov. You know, like one of these things, we won't know how it will be, like the Rambam say, until it will be. Then you will see the entire picture. I say, the first thing that will happen, as soon as the liberal lefty Jews will see that the Jews building Beit HaMikdash, there are going to be riots all over Israel. Animal rights! Shame on you! Go back to Iran! Right or wrong? They won't let you kill one sheep. Today you give a smack to a dog, you go to jail in Israel. Why you give him a smack? He was barking all night, didn't let me sleep. Animal rights. Yalla, prosecution. Lawyer from the government, 100,000 shekel. Why? Sisi, the dog, got a patch. Animals have more rights than people today. These liberal lefties, when Jewish children are murdered by Arabs, not a beep you hear from them. When you see one person torture an animal, they make demonstrations for hours. Okay, you want to demonstrate that animals suffer, no problem at all. It's a very nice thing to do. But why doesn't bother you that Jewish children are slaughtered by Hamas terrorists? You don't make a beep, nothing. The opposite, they go to comfort the parents of the terrorists that their son got shot. They go, they sit with them by the Arab villages. Mustafa, we feel so bad for your son, a warrior of freedom. Ahmed, may peace be on him, imach shimam v'zichram. Come, eat with us, give him coffee. Yes, yes. That's what's happening. Can you believe it? Imagine now in America, there's an Arab terrorist that went with a car and hit few people in Manhattan, that his parents live here in Brooklyn, and they make now a special tent in the neighborhood and giving out candies, baklava, falafel, and then American congressmen and all kinds of artists and Hollywood stars coming. Mustafa, we feel so bad for Muhammad, your son. It's the American's fault. Why should not kill as much as he wants? It's freedom. In America, it's also liberal people. But imagine something like this would happen right here in Brooklyn. What would happen? Huh? Do you think it can happen here or no? Maybe some liberal Jews will do it. They will still come from Manhattan. They don't like to leave Manhattan. But they would come to say, we're very sorry for your son, the terrorist. Why they call him terrorist? It's not fair. You know, speaking about Iran, there's riots in Iran now. It's already 9 days of riots. Supposedly every day more and more people, mainly students. Who makes the demonstration? Who usually fight religion? Students. In Israel, same thing. In Iran, same things. In Egypt, same things. The more educated a person is, the more he hates God. The more ungrateful he is to God, the more he hates religion, and the more he hates religious people. Why? Because he wants the value of the university to cancel the values of the Torah. That's why they brainwash him in the university. Gay rights, men with men should get married, people should marry to animals if that's what they like. Terrorists have the right for freedom. No one should go into their bank account and check what attack they're preparing to kill us. You have to give them rights. You have to feed them in jail with good food and give them a special doctor to take care of their teeth. Why? That's what they teach in university. All corruption. Who is the most educated people in the world? Jews. Everywhere you go. Every country I go. Top people in the government, in offices, are all Jews. I was in Costa Rica. Three vice presidents of Costa Rica participated in the Shabbaton. Vice president of the country. Everyone over there was with degrees from universities here in New York. Not from Costa Rica. They all come to America to learn. Not all, but many. All educated. I don't think there was one person over there without university. It's very far from religion. Baruch Hashem, there's already a lot of Baalei Tshuva, Tzadikim, wonderful people that make a change and became religious. I'm not talking about them. I'm talking those who are far, who did not even participate in the Shabbaton. The more educated you are, the more anti-Torah you are, because that's what they brainwash you in the university. Same thing in the Arab countries, same thing in Iran. Not that I come to justify the Iranian wicked regime. They are just as bad as the Nazis. If they could, they would do just exactly what the Nazis do to the Jews. There's no question here. But we're not coming to justify them. I'm just saying who usually hates religion. Whether it's Islam, whether it's Christianity, whether it's Judaism, doesn't matter what religion. It's the students. They are the ones who organize all the riots. Same thing now in Iran. All the educated students, they only have Facebook, Twitter, WhatsApp, all these things, and they all learn together in the universities, and they constantly talk about it for many, many years. And they head up to here. They want freedom. They want their girls to walk naked on the street. They want to go to beaches like it used to be. They want to do whatever they want. They don't want police come and grab your wife and put her in a car and take her to jail because she went with high heels or mini skirt or she didn't cover her face. They don't like it. They hate religion. They force the religion on them. That's, by the way, a mistake they do in Israel. Instead of teaching the secular, the chilonim, that the Torah is from God, and why it's worth it for them to change, like we, the Mekarvim, do, they actually try to force the religion and the laws of the religion on the most ignorant people in the world. That's a very bad mistake. They try to force them to close on Shabbat, not to open their businesses on Shabbat, not to do all kinds of things, but they don't even believe in God. They don't believe in the Torah, and they don't believe in Shabbat. For them, it's the most stupid laws. So how you expect them not to hate religion? The more you force it on them, the more they hate it. Not only the secular people hate religion, if you force it on them. Our own children hate it because the parents force it on them. I had one time here in Brooklyn a lecture in the days of the overhead projector, before the laptops even came out, maybe 20 years ago, in the house of Israeli guy, family. And there was an Israeli Yemenite guy over there that was so anti-religion. You have no idea. The entire 2 hours that I was there, he was screaming and barking and cursing. You saw right away that this guy has such hate to the religion. Everything I say, fights and scream and argue. At one point, I said, this is not normal. I mean, yeah, you can hate something. You come to a lecture of Torah, and all you do is bark and scream and being arrogant. Would you let us continue the lecture or no? So he said to me, you want to see who I was? Yes. He took out his wallet and he took a small black and white passport picture from many years ago. Remember, this was 20 years ago and the picture was for 20 years earlier. So we're talking a picture from 40 years ago, black and white. Here! I look at him, old beard, two simonim like the Yemenite, and black hat. Bachur Yeshiva. That's who I was. So what happened, I ask? He say, you see me how I am? It's all my father's fault. Why? My father forced me to learn on Shabbat Torah when all my friends were playing outside. He made me hate the religion. I cannot look at it. So I say to him, but the actions of your father obviously is not in the Torah. It's against the Torah. Because your father made a crime against the Torah and against Hashem, now you decided also to punish Hashem, to run away from him. Then he told me in front of everyone, he said, listen to what I'm talking to you. I was sitting on a couch on Shabbat. My father was sitting on the other couch, falling asleep like this. Every few minutes he opened up his eyes to see if I'm learning the Gemara. And you know, I hear all my friends playing outside. And I'm sitting there, he's forcing me now to learn when I don't want to go outside with my friends. So what happened? When he saw I'm not learning, he took a rock, a big heavy stone, he put it under my chin, and he took a band-aid and went like this around my head, that it was so heavy, I was a kid, that I cannot pick up my head from the Gemara, because it was so heavy, I couldn't pick up my head. I didn't have the strength to pick up my head, so my head was automatically down on the Gemara. You're not going to learn? I will show you. No wonder, it's a miracle he did not become a mass murderer. It's only that he did not become religious. Mazal that he did not become a serial killer with such foolish parents. And many religious people do the same thing. Force. I understand, they do it out of pain. They know the religion. They know the consequences of being secular. They know that you go off the derech, you lose your olam haba. We all know it. And believe it or not, many of these children also know it. But it's a psychological issue already. That's it. They now need to rebel. Sometimes a few years and then they come back. There's some very big rabbis today in the world. One of them learned with me in yeshiva. And he had a period, I think, between 16 to 20. And he went off the derech. He was learning in very good yeshivot until 16. Something happened to him. He ran away from Israel to America. And we, back then, 20 years ago, we brought him back into the yeshiva. We took him to a seminar. I was in the beginning of my career, meaning speaking. And I was learning in yeshiva. And we brought him back into the yeshiva. And quickly, he got into it because he already had all the knowledge. And he learned. Then he moved to Israel and he became a very famous speaker. Since I mention him now, yesterday I heard a story from him that you all have to hear. There's one guy here in Queens. That he does business with Samsonite, the suitcase company, a billion-dollar company. Samsonite, they sell suitcases, wholesaler, serious dealer. He sells to an Arab businessman in Dubai. The Arab made an order from this Israeli Jew, Baal Tshuva, living here in Queens. An order, guess for how much? How much? $940,000. Every suitcase costs $100. You do the math, thousands of suitcases to be exported to Dubai. He said to him, the Israeli, no problem, send me 150,000. First, he wants to secure his profit. Send me 150,000. Once I have it, I'll place the order and ship it to you. And then you pay upon receiving. No problem, the Arab sent 150, then he sent the rest of the money. He wired him $940,000. In the meantime, there was a misunderstanding by the Arab businesses, and someone from the office also made a wire for $940,000. Imagine how much money they run, these Arab sheikhs. That $940,000, it's like you make a mistake in $9 here in a coffee shop. Oh, by mistake, my friend paid, I paid again, give me back the $9. That's how it goes over there. I have one of my students, he sells in Los Angeles in a mall, used to. Until I told him it's not such a kosher business, Baruch Hashem, he left it. He said to me, I can be all week not making money, until one Arab woman showed up from Bahrain, Dubai, Saudi, one of the wives of these billionaires. $50,000. Everything she see, give me this, give me that. That's going to make me look younger. Yeah, yeah, it's going to put this cream. How much? $5,000. No problem. This iron, you take it with you. If your clothes is wrinkled on the spot, it doesn't have a wire. This, that, it's rechargeable. He buys it in China, $7, sell it for $300. Oh, give me for my sister this, that, another $2,000. $50,000. On American Express. No limit. For the whole month. So this guy, he sent $940,000, and the business also sent $940,000. This juicy, another wire for $940,000. No, no another order. Listen to this. Right away he ran to the rabbi. Rabbi, look what happened. Now what am I supposed to do? The rabbi said to him, we're not allowed to steal from the goyim. That's what the Torah says. You're going to a store of a goy, you're not allowed to steal from him. You're not allowed to cheat him. You're not allowed to deceive him. When you sell him something, you're not allowed. It's all against the Torah. But if the goy lost something, you don't have an obligation to run after him and give it back to him. Just when you have with your brother, the Jew. That's the only difference. You're not allowed to steal. You're not allowed to cheat. You're not allowed to deceive. None of this is allowed. If you do it, it's a sin from the Torah. You should know it. Or if you take a loan from a goy and you don't pay him back, it's stealing. Same thing. But if the goy lost his money on the floor and you found it, you don't have to run and look who is this guy, where does he live, to make an investigation and to give it back. So the rabbi said to him, maybe Hashem send you extra money. What do you want me to tell you? You ask me what's the law? The law is you can keep the money. But this guy is such an honest guy. He said to the rabbi, I can't, rabbi. I cannot take money. It's not mine. Even if I found it, even if it's a mistake, I cannot do it. I can't live with myself. So he called to look for that Arab guy. 3 days he's looking for him. He doesn't answer his calls, nothing. What happened in the end? He said, well, something is not right here. He called the office, Sam. I'm the one who's supposed to deliver him the suitcases. I'm working with him. I've been trying to reach him for 3 days. So, okay, let us give you his wife's telephone number. He called up the wife. She speaks French. He doesn't speak Arabic. She doesn't speak Hebrew or English. He has to speak to her in French, but his French is not so good. He knows a few words. So he said to her, I want to return to you. $940,000, give me please your husband's bank account number. She doesn't understand. In French, he said the wrong names. She heard money. She got angry. She said, why are you calling? My husband died. The Arab died. You're calling me now for money? Boom, she hung up. Meaning she thought that the husband owed him money and he has the nerve a day after he died to call for the money. She didn't understand, because who would believe that somebody from America call, he wants to send you money. You made a mistake, I want to return you the money. You know, it usually doesn't happen. Then he got someone who speaks French, call again. That person called. Now you see, after something like this happened, that the wife said to you, leave us alone, don't call here anymore. What would you say? Ishtabach shem. I came to be a tzaddik. I did everything I can. The rabbi told me you're allowed to keep it. I went to be more righteous than the rabbi and the halakha. I call, they hang up on me. Baruch Hashem, it means Hashem wants to give me this money, no? But an honest guy don't make himself all kinds of shortcuts. He found someone that speaks French. He tells him what to say. He explained to the woman. The woman was shocked. He wants to return to me $940,000. Here is the bank account number. He wired them back the money. That was the end of the story. 2 months later, he sits in his house in Queens. He lives in a private house, and downstairs is his office. Somebody knocks on his door. He checks from there. Oh, what? An Arab person, dressed like a sheikh, and all kinds of bodyguards around him. Excuse me, can I help you? Are you Mr. Such and Such? Yes. We came all the way from Dubai to meet with you. I'm sorry, listen, I don't know who you are. I'm afraid to open the door, you know. Imagine Arabs knock on your door. You see somebody with kafiya, this, like this. Don't worry. We came because we found out that you sent the money back to the wife of Khalil, whatever his name is. We want to just verify with you if it's true, the story. So I got the impression that they're not hostile. He opened the door, tfaddal, come in. They came in. They say to him, tell us the truth. Did you really actually send back the money on your own? I say, yes. Wow, you see, I'm a religious Jew. Cannot steal. The guy told him, I tell you, I came all the way from Dubai to meet you personally. I am so impressed by you that I want to hire you to be my representative in the United States to all my businesses. He already made more than 10 times of this $940,000 from this Arab guy, and it's time just started to tick. Time is ticking. And I make probably who knows how many millions. That's why I've been screaming for years. Not me, the Torah. Nobody ever, ever, ever can ever lose from doing the right thing that the Torah commands. Torah say, even though you don't have an obligation to run for the go and find him, but if you do it, it's a very big Kiddush Hashem. You actually make the name of God greater in the eyes of the people around you. Look at this religious Jew, how he came all the way to give us back the money, even though we didn't know about it. Wow. Or if you come to a department store, I'm sorry, you send me by mistake 2 packages. Here is one back. I order only one. You gave me by mistake 2. Oh, sir, there's sometimes... But if you don't have a yarmulke, what's the point? I don't know who you are. You go, you might as well get the Kiddush Hashem. That's worse than anything, Kiddush Hashem. Going back to what we said. So we have to understand why, if you don't say Bet HaMikdash in Birkat HaMazon, the temple, it's like you did not say Birkat HaMazon. The Rambam say is promising that the king of Mashiach, when he comes, he has to come from the family genealogy of King David. That's, by the way, proof that Christianity, it's all false. In case you wonder, that's one of the proofs. That the New Testament begins with the genealogy of the father of JC, supposedly Joseph the carpenter. They linked him all the way to King David. They show you over 30 generations who was the father of who. And now, Joseph, and Joseph got Miriam, and they got married. And he came after a few months, and he sees she's pregnant. And what happened to you? I never touched you. Don't worry, God came to me and he made me pregnant. I'm still a virgin. And, you know, if he's going to go and complain about her, they'll kill her. Execution. So they ended up, he moved in. JC is born. They send JC to yeshiva. They make him bar mitzvah. They give him tefillin. I wonder if JC would come back to life now and a day of Christmas, and see all the trees, and see all these American people in Texas, Dallas, all these places, Milwaukee, Chicago. Excuse me, I would speak to them Hebrew. We don't understand. What do you want, guy? Excuse me. Hey, Jew. Hey, Jew boy. What are you doing here? It's not a place of Jews. My name is J.C. Penney. Who? You don't know me? I was born in Nazareth, this. What? You J.C.? Oh, my God. Wait a minute. What's all these trees? It's for you. For your birthday. That's not my birthday, you fool. Oh, well, it's not my birthday. It's December 25th. Who told you this nonsense? What's all these statues and this? This is all for you, your mother Mary. Oof. Statues? Idols? What's all this? How come you don't have yarmulke? Where is your tzitzit? What's going on here? They won't know where to hide. We're all celebrating your holiday. Everything they do in Christmas, JC would spit at it. Jewish people today, when they hear the word JC, they get goosebumps. Ugh, Shemirachem. Rasha! Wicked! I promise you, Rabotai, if JC would come today and give a speech and we upload it to YouTube, it would have over 1 million views in a minute. And after a week, half of the people of Brooklyn would stand online to get a bracha from him. From his knowledge in Torah, from the way he was dressed, with his beard. Of course, he didn't have that stupid long hair that they made in Brazil. He's standing like this, with his long hair. That's, by the way, proof that they're all lying. When they come and say, oh, Jace, I died, I had clinical death, I saw JC. How JC look? They all describe him like a hippie. Huh? It looks more like, what's his name, this rock and roll star? ZZ Top, Mick Jagger, whatever. They made JC a hippie from the rock and roll star, you know? And what's the name of this bar? What are you talking about? Well, JC had beard, he was wearing kilts. What a nonsense, turban. What, he was a hippie from Brazil, standing like this with a goatee. And his body like this. 1 gram of brain they don't have. Anyway, how we got to this guy, now? Anyway, so the Rambam says, the Rambam is promising, it says like this. When the Mashiach come, one of the signs to know if he's a Mashiach, he will force the entire nation of Israel, it will shake them up and wake them up to keep all the Torah. He will do all the wars of Hashem against the wicked Goyim that torture us for thousands of years. He would purify the entire world. If you see someone that did it in his lifetime, that's a chazakah, that's a status, a certainty that he is a potential Mashiach. Remember now, there's two titles. There is the Messiah, but there is someone that is a potential Messiah. You know what's the difference? You can have 10 potential Messiah in one generation. If they're all from the family of King David, they all have a family tree, they're all righteous, they're all Talmidei Chachamim, they're all people that has all the skills that a Mashiach is supposed to have. Each one of them is a potential to become the Messiah when Hashem will decide. Once they died, it's over. You understand? How do we know it? From the Gemara. The Gemara says Rabbi Akiva was sure that Bar Kochva is the Messiah. Bar Kochva. When he died, the snake beat him and he died. They changed his name from Bar Kochva to Bar Koziva. What does it mean, Bar Koziva? Koziva comes from the word Achzava, disappointment. He fooled all of us. And Rabbi Akiva said, I was mistaken. Rabbi Akiva did not say, the Rebbe never died. He's right here. We see him sitting on a chair. We got to get a blessing from him 20 years after he passed away. He didn't say all this nonsense. Rabbi Akiva immediately admitted that he made a mistake. Why? Once Rabbi Akiva, once Bar Kokhba died, immediately he knew that he wasn't the Messiah and it was all a mistake. He did not continue with his ego, no, you are wrong, he's alive, he never died, he's still the Messiah, he's going to come back. None of this nonsense. Immediately he admitted, I was wrong. Why? Why are you wrong? If the Messiah can come from the grave, say, okay, we didn't have the merit that Bar Kokhba will save us. When Hashem will decide, he's going to come back and be the Messiah. No, he didn't say none of that. Why? Because he knew. Once he passed, he passed. Okay, but listen to the words of the Rambam. You also, in order for you to be a potential Messiah, it's not enough that you're a very big rabbi. It's not enough that you're very holy. It's not enough that you're very modest. It's not enough that you have 100,000 students. It's not enough that you teach Torah to a million people every day. It's not enough. There is another condition. What do you have to do? You have to gather all the Jewish people into Israel. In your lifetime. You begin to move all the Jews into Israel. Nobody ever done it in the last 2,000 years. You have to make a war against all the anti-Semite Jew haters. All these Europeans and all these Arabs and all these people that constantly torture us for 2,000 years and give them what they deserve. He never did it. He never did it. Anyone, no one ever did it. So, the Rambam writes, let me read to you word by word that you don't say, make it up. Like this you'll see. The Rambam say, "Umi malchut bet David," you have to have a proof that you're from the family of David, "שיקוף את ישראל לקיים את התורה וילחם את מלחמות השם." He will fight the wars of God. הרי זה בחזקת משיח. ואם בנה בית המקדש, if he built the בית המקדש, in the place of Jerusalem where the Arabs have their mosque right now, meaning that the mosque will be cleaned away from there, and they're going to build the בית המקדש the way it should be, וקיבץ נדחי ישראל, and he gathered all the Jewish people from all the exile into Israel, הרי זה משיח ודאי. That's a guarantee that this is the Mashiach. So until we find a Jew in a history that did all of that, you can say it's בחזקת משיח, if he has other conditions. But you cannot, it's not allowed to say this rabbi is Mashiach, this Jew is Mashiach, my rabbi is holy, is a Mashiach more than anyone else. It's against the law. Because the Rambam brings conditions, what the Mashiach has to do. There are six conditions. Nobody in our days and no one in the last 2,000 years fulfilled the six conditions. The maximum that people reached is three of the six conditions. What about the other three conditions? They never got to that point. So obviously they were not Bechizkat Mashiach and they're not Mashiach. They can be holy people, yeah. Yeah.
Who's going to be Moshe Rabbeinu? Moshe Rabbeinu has ended all the Shvatim. He has Yehuda. He has everything. So therefore, he will be Mashiach if he comes from the dead.
I wonder what's his source that Moshe Rabbeinu can come back. No. Maybe in the resurrection of the dead. Okay. Tov. Now. So why we have to mention Bet HaMikdash inside Birkat HaMazon? Someone who is asking the kingdom of David, King David, to come back, automatically is asking for the temple to get rebuilt. Because it's one depend on the other. What do you need Mashiach for? Not to build Bet HaMikdash? What good is that? It's like someone gave you a car without wheels. What are you going to do with that? You need wheels. So it says, Memeile bikesh gam ken al hakamat Bet HaMikdash. What territory Bet HaMikdash was in, where the Western Wall is? Which tribe got it when they came to Israel? Binyamin and Yehuda. Part of it in Binyamin, part of it in Yehuda. So, it's very important principle to ask and mention that Hashem will return the kingdom of King David back into his place. And that's what we say every Shabbat when we do the Haftarah. When we read the Haftarah, what do we say? Al kis'o lo yoshev zar. No stranger should sit on the chair of King David. Ve'lo yirshu acherim et kvodo. Nobody, as much as he's holy, and as much as he's Talmid Chacham, and as much as he's a great rabbi, no one has permission to steal the chair of the real King David genealogy. So if by saying, my rabbi is Mashiach, just because you love him, you're actually breaking a very serious rule and foundations against Hashem. Now you see the consequences of it soon. This is the main blessing that Yaakov blessed Yehuda. Yaakov gave each one of the tribes. What's the blessing? Lo yasur shevet mi Yehuda. Lo yasur shevet mi Yehuda. Ad ki yavo shilo velo ikat amim. Until the Mashiach would come, Shiloh, it's one of the names of Mashiach. As the Gemara brings four names, possible names. Until the day that Mashiach will be revealed, no one is allowed to claim the chair of King David. That's the blessing that Yaakov gave Yehuda. Are we allowed to nominate a king in the meantime that is not from the family of King David? Temporarily, yes. We allowed to take another righteous Jew and make him a king, even though he's not from the tribe of King David or from his family. Right? Even though he's not from the tribe of Yehuda. As long as he's not a son of a non-Jewish woman, meaning a convert, or definitely a goy. Someone that was naturally born Jewish. In America, you can be the president of the United States only if you're born in America. For instance, I have an American passport. So I'm 100% American citizen with all the rights of any American that was born in this country, except one. I can never become the president of the United States. Never. That's why I wasn't born in America. Half of the New York people were not born in America. It's a lot of immigrants. Even if they have an American passport, even if they are in politics, they cannot be the president. That was the argument with Trump against Obama all these years. He claimed that he was born out of America. And he showed a birth certificate and all kinds of things to prove that Obama was not born in America. Whether it's true or not, I don't know. But one thing I do know, that no president in the history of the world made more damage to the world more than Obama. You have no idea how much damage he made to the world. But I want to tell you something else. We all are afraid from Iran. Iran, 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 Iran. In Israel, half of the budget of the army is all for Iran. North Korea, we don't have so much business with. They're also very dangerous, but they're not direct enemies of Israel. But Iran, they declare nonstop that their goal is to wipe out Israel. If they had a chance to wipe out Israel, they would do it even with 2 million Arabs there. 2 million Arabs there. The only doubt I have is the mosques that they have over there. Maybe that will make them not do it. Because they all love this mosque. They believe this is the place where Muhammad went. Later on, they started to make all kinds of fairy tale that Muhammad went with heaven, to heaven, on his donkey, whatever, on his Rolls Royce, whatever it was, went up to heaven. You understand? So maybe one of the main reasons that if they had the opportunity to shoot a missile at Israel, maybe what will save us in the end is this, that Hashem already saw it coming, he made them build this mosque over there and fight for Jerusalem, maybe that will save us in the end. But I want to tell you something. North Korea, that's a crazy leader over there. Little boy, little kid, not normal. You can see right away that he's a bully. Probably got some punches in school. Now he takes his anger at the world. And Trump is not exactly the person you wanted to have a fight with him. So we have an entertainment show. According to this crazy one, what's his name? Kim, whatever. He has a button on his desk that aimed to all over the United States, meaning he can now decide to shoot at us as we're here in New York. All of a sudden, we won't be here in New York. This is how he talks. Meaning he got already to a level of threats. Trump said today, I want to remind him I have a much bigger button. And my button works. Meaning you can tell your fairy tales to someone else. Let me ask you a question. How long do you think it takes to eliminate this crazy Korean leader? To kill him? How easy it is? Do you know how easy it is? Nothing ever been so easy to kill any leader and any terrorist in a history like today. You don't need to send commando. You don't need parachuters to land over there like the Entebbe, the Israeli. You don't need all this. All you have to do is to send drones. 15-year-old kids can fly drones from anywhere in the world, from South Korea to North Korea in an hour, with the best HD cameras and missiles that can knock down a million people. They can put chemical on it, biological weapon, they can put even nuclear on it. Or regular missiles. The drone is the size of a small plane. You sit on a screen in Israel, in Tel Aviv, everywhere in the world. You send the drones to Lebanon. You can see now the drone is very, very high. They don't even hear it. It's like a helicopter. It stands in the air and he filmed a speech from the Hezbollah leader with all the terrorists around him. In 1 second, he can blow them all up. They won't even know where it came from. Same thing they can do to this guy. So today the war is not what it used to be. When I was a soldier, it was a whole different strategy. Today, it's all cyber war. It's all who is going to be the best and most brilliant in computers, best hackers. If you are a criminal hacker and the government is convinced that you have skills that average people don't have, not only they don't send you for 20 years in prison, immediately they give you an American passport, come work for the CIA. Today I went to visit someone in jail, and there was one Israeli person there in a jail, that he actually hacked the biggest bank in the world and took many millions of dollars out of their account. This is how powerful this hacker is. Supposedly is one top Israeli genius in computer that the Americans say to him, whatever you want, we'll give you. And there was another Russian partner with him, also some kind of a genius. He immediately will give you passport, stay here, salary, everything. Criminal, convicted criminal, federal crime. Right away we forget about everything. Why? We need you against Iran, we need you against these people. When we have people in your, with your ability, you can go into the bank account of Ahmadinejad and the other one and everyone. I know one of my students that for years was listening every day to Ahmadinejad conversation in Farsi, translating it to the Mossad. Every one of his conversations. One guy. He speak Farsi, right away they recruit him to the Mossad. So why they don't kill them? If the Israeli can kill them in a minute, and America is just as good. Why they don't put him out and finish this saga? All this show now. Just blow his head up and finish. His country also wanted to happen. He can do it also to the Iranian regime. The problem with these dictators that are not stupid. It's like a poker game. You don't know what your opponent has. He now is putting a nice show. He has a very serious card. You don't know what he has. It's a big risk. This crazy guy, he said to America, what do you think, that if you're going to kill me, it's going to solve your problem? There's 100 people here in North Korea with access to the button. As soon as I get murdered by anyone, an atomic bomb would fall in somewhere in the United States. I can't take the risk. I know these crazy people will do it in a minute, without hesitation. Same thing the Iranians, what do you think? Or the Hezbollah guys. There's no problem. We have a weapon against you that we still did not use. You're going to kill our leader, that's what's going to happen to you. They worry. It's the only insurance they have. many reporters that they discover corruption in a government or corruption by the FBI or the CIA, they want to put them out. They want to kill them. The smart ones, they know they're going to kill them. If he invented a very big medicine that will make, that will cure millions of people, and they, and all this pharmaceutical company would lose billions of dollars. So right away, he knows I'm a scientist. In one day, they'll kill me. So what do they do if they're smart? They say, listen to me. I did not publish my medicine yet, but if you're going to kill me, it's already in a safe place with my lawyer. As soon as you're going to kill me, I'll publish it free in the internet all over the world. And I already know it's going to cost them $100 billion in the next 5 years. If he published the medicine, it's going to be all over the internet. Right away, everyone will do it and prepare the medicine, and they're not going to sell. That's the only... You know how dangerous it is to be a scientist? To invent things? If you invent something that the government doesn't like, right away your life is in the highest risk. They actually kill their own citizen. Why? National security. They call the president, confirm, boom. They kill them. They pretend it was an accident, plane crash. Speaking about plane crash, unfortunately a plane crashed 2 days ago on the way to Costa Rica. 8 Jews died on that plane. The family of 5 Reform Jews, they all died, Steinberg, and another family, 3 people, wives, I don't know what they were, what kind of Jews they were, I don't know, but all 8 people died on the way to Costa Rica. Why people go to Costa Rica? They have rainforest over there with lions and tigers. When I was in Costa Rica, they asked me, maybe you extend your trip. We'll take you to see the baboons and the tigers. You understand? People come specially there. They fly specially for vacation over there to go to those places. And it's only an hour away from San Jose to those places. So anyway, that's the reason why they don't put them out. But I want to ask you one question. How many Jews the Goyim murdered in the last 3,300 years from the minute we got the Torah until today? How many? 20 million? 40 million? 100 million? Many millions. We all know it's just the Holocaust were millions, and there are so many pogroms, and every day there's attacks all over the world. It's another 2, it's another 5, it's another 10. It adds up to who knows how what. The destruction of the first temple, they slaughter hundreds of thousands of people, the city of Betar. It comes to many million Jews, unfortunately. More than any other nation in history, without a doubt. Even the Goyim admit, nobody suffered more than the Jewish people in history. But I have news for you. You're sitting down? Take all the amount of people that they ever murder, whether it's 50 million, whether it's 100 million, only Hashem knows. It doesn't come to 1% of how many Jews we, the Jewish people, murder with our own hands. Do you understand what I say here or no? Intermarriage already killed 4 billion Jews, intermarriage, assimilation, Jews who married non-Jews. We and the Chinese people started in the same generation after the flood 4,200 years ago. The Chinese people are close to 2 billion people with restriction on birth. Until a few years ago, they could only have 1 kid per family. They were not allowed to have 10 kids, 7 kids, 13 kids. The Jews, until 30 years ago when they invented birth control, they never had any restriction on birth. An average Jewish family had between 1 kid or no kids to 20 kids. When I was in yeshiva, there was one rabbi teaching in my yeshiva. He had 23 kids with 1 wife. 23 kids, twins and another twins, All together, 23 kids he had. And was sitting and learning Torah all day, and Hashem took care of all of them, and they're all married, Baruch Hashem. Without college degree. Right? Hashem feeds everyone. What do you worry? Anyway, listen to this. So if the Jews would not marry other nations as the Torah forbid, and they would pay attention to Hashem, and they would listen to his instruction and restrictions, we should have been easy, at least 4 billion Jews. At least double than the Chinese. They have only one kid. We had 10, 13, 15. Multiply by many generations. Minimum 4 billion Jews we should have been. Reality, how many Jews are in the world? 13 million. How many we lost? 4 billion at least. Who killed them? We! So why do we complain about Iran, the Palestinians, the Arabs, the Nazis, the Romans? Everyone they killed is now 1% of how much we killed by betraying Hashem. Assimilation. Almost every American married goyim here. Nobody cared b'chlal. It's a lost case already. Rabbi, can you speak to my cousin? Rabbi, can you speak to my nephew? Rabbi, can you speak to my neighbor? Now you're waking up. 20 years of brainwashing in a public school and in universities. Everybody is equal. No this, no that. And of course, that's how you raise them. They don't have any appreciation to the Torah. What do I care that God said not to marry other nations? I'm not religious. She's a good girl. That's it. You understand? Everyone got angry at me when I say how many of the 6 millions, according to the Torah, they were Jewish. Instead of crying about our situation, they worry about how many I said. 2 million, 5 million, 3. Stupidity like this. You worry about what I say? How come none of them is worried about 4 billion Jews that went to the garbage and they're all gone? For that, nobody cries. Did you ever see a Holocaust day for 4 billion Jews that were intentionally murdered by us? Not by the Arabs. Not by the European. We actually killed our own future, our own nations. Everyone who goes and marries someone from another nation declared a war against God and betrayed him. And you know what the biggest problem? That 99% of the Jews who does it don't even feel for a second they did something wrong. And you know why? Because we gave them education of goyim and they became goyim. And now in 5 minutes you cannot make them Jewish. That's it. 20 years you pump into their head all the nonsense of the schools and the television and the movies and the college. And now you want the rabbi to do hocus pocus and save them? You can forget about it. I want to ask you a question. Do you think that all these demonstrations in Iran, do you think it will succeed? Do you think the Iranian people will be able to make a revolution there? You know, they tried a few years ago. They butchered them. Put thousands of them in jail. I saw a picture of what they did to him. I was sick for a week. They hang people 3 days upside down. They tie all kinds of things to make them the worst pain. It gets swollen, organs in the body become like watermelon. You can, Mengele, what he did, something similar to that. They do to their own people for screaming and demonstrating against the corrupted regime. These people are very brave. It just shows you how much they suffer, that they're willing to take that risk going on the street. If they catch them, it's like immediately as soon as you get caught, it's like right away going to Auschwitz. No difference that they do to them, to their own people. I saw pictures someone took from inside the jails of Iran, what they do to their own citizens. You're not going to believe that it's possible to have such cruelty. And these students and all these Iranians that don't want to, that they fight against this government, they all know that that's what's going to happen to them. And not only that, also the entire family. They do it to the whole family, to the parents, to the brother, to everybody. This is like committing suicide. When does a person commit suicide? When he cannot take it anymore. That's it. Whatever happened, happened. I don't care. There's only one problem. The Iranian government is not Israelis, and they're not European, and they don't have human rights, and they don't care about anyone. They cut the internet. There's no more Facebook, no more this. Now all the communication that they had doesn't work. No internet, no WhatsApp doesn't work. Until now, there's WhatsApp group. Please be in this place tomorrow between this time and this. We're going to make the whole area. We'll break windows. We're going to burn bus stops. We're going to make a riot. Now there's no more internet. No communication, no chance to succeed. Unless if Hashem wants to do the job, he'll find how. But the people cannot do it. There's a question in the Torah, why Hashem punished the Egyptian people for the crimes of Paro? Paro was the Hitler of that time. Punish him. Why you punish his nation? It wasn't a democratic election. It wasn't a democratic election. Paro is a king. You don't like me, I kill you. Just like in Iran, just like in North Korea. Even in Russia it's like this. You go against Putin, you go to jail. Maybe he doesn't hang you in the middle of town like they do in Iran. But they, believe me, they take care of them very good. So what do you want from the Egyptians? The answer is, Rabotai, first of all, the Egyptians were happy that it's happening. If they didn't like it, that's one thing. They were happy. Why? They had free slaves. Imagine you live in a house in Ocean Parkway and you have five maids and you don't have to ever pay them. Clean here and be quiet. Clean here, clean the bathroom, go shopping, do this for me, work in a business, clean here, carry boxes. As many slaves you want. Make the roads, fix this, fix that, clean the snow from the cars. They're very happy. Wow, what a great president we have. He got us million slaves for free. They were all happy. If they were not happy, they should have demonstrated. Soon I'm going to talk about what Paro said to the Mealdot about killing the babies. Very, very strange. One of the strangest things in the Torah. Paro come to Shifra and Pua. Who is Shifra and Pua? Yocheved and Miriam. How old was Yocheved? How old was she? Huh? No, that's Miriam. How old was Yocheved? 130 years old. 100. Remember, she didn't give birth to Moshe yet. Soon Moshe will get into the picture. Moshe is younger than Aaron by 3 years. So Aaron is a little baby. Miriam is 5 years old. Miriam is 5 years old. The Meyaldot is the mother that is 130 years old with a cane like this. Hi, Paro. What do you want? I want you to kill all the Jewish boys that will be born. And take your daughter, the 5 years old, Miriam, to help you. You know, while you're chopping their heads off, let her hold and hold, help you, get you what you need, the tools. Isn't it strange? And it gets even stranger. Why does it get stranger? Because now, it says in the Torah, they feared God. He said to them, if it's a girl, let her live. If it's a boy, kill him. But kill him before he comes out. Why? Because when they come to Paro and say, what do you want from us? By the time we got called to the house to deliver the baby was out like animals. These Jewish women are different than the Egyptians. When you come to an Egyptian woman, she screams, I, 4 hours to induce the delivery. By the time we got to the Jew, the baby is already outside like this on the table. So Paro should have said to them, what do I care? I told you to kill all the babies, no? Paro took their excuse, didn't do anything to them. How can it be? If I told you to kill all the babies, the male, what do I care, the inside or outside? So from here we understand that the order was kill them only before they came out. Why? Abortion is legal in Egypt. As long as the baby didn't come out, you can still kill him until a minute before he's born. If you don't believe that they do it in the United States and in Israel, you are dreaming. Even a week before the baby is supposed to be born in the ninth month, they inject all kinds of chumtza and salt inside. After he dies, they do a cesarean, they take him out and put him in a garbage bag. In private clinics, they won't do it in the Israeli hospitals. Over there, they only do abortion until the third month, fourth month, whatever, when the baby is very small. But once he's already a full baby, 9 months old, all you have to do is to go to private places that do it. And they sell the babies to China. I don't want to tell you what they do with that, why Chinese need to buy them. It's too much for one night. You can search online and see where that baby is. So until a minute before they give birth, they still do it in this country. And if they catch the doctor that did it, they do nothing to him. He's not going to jail for 40 years for murdering. They know nothing in America, nothing. They know there's abortions like this. Now, one time the FBI goes to those places and arrests the doctors for killing babies a minute before they're born. So the same thing is here in Egypt. Paro understands that if the baby came out, I cannot instruct you to murder them. Because my nation will learn from it to kill people. They tell me, how come here it's allowed and here not? It's against the law. If it's against the law, it's against the law to everyone. If it's with the law, then we're allowed to kill anyone we don't like. So he has a problem. So he can only instruct them to kill the babies while the baby didn't come out. But in that case, how will they know if it's a boy or a girl? What, they had MRI? Sonogram? Huh? So we have two options here. One, maybe they had a way to know the sex of the baby in the old days before they come out. Maybe by the skin, I don't know. Possible, because they had knowledge in the old days that today is gone from the world. Maybe that's one option. Second option is, according to the Torah, if the baby jeopardized the life of the mother, who do you kill to save who? You kill the mother to save the baby, or you kill the baby to save the mother? Whose life comes first? The baby is a threat to the mother. The mother already has a life. The baby wants to gain life, to come out. But the baby is going to kill his mother. You don't give life to someone new to kill someone old. It doesn't work that way. So as long as the baby didn't come out and the doctors realize that their wife is going to die any minute, if we're not going to do something, they're allowed to kill the baby to save the life of the mother, and it's not a murder. It's a life risk, pikuach nefesh. But if the baby took his head out, even a little bit, the head came out, you cannot kill him anymore. Because the soul is in the head. Once the head came out, it doesn't even matter the rest of the body. He already has his own life. Because before he came out, he eats and breathes from the mother's cord. It's an unbelievable miracle happened. As soon as he comes and supposed to breathe, that second, Hashem closed all the opens inside and opened all the claws for the baby. Inside his mother's womb, he did not try to breathe with his nose and his mouth. Because if he would do it, he will choke from all the blood and all the dirt. He will die. He cannot. Everything is closed. The nose, the mouth. The second he comes out, it gets opened up. It's unbelievable timing. That's enough for every fool to understand that Hashem runs the world. And life and creation is only by Him. No evolution and none of their nonsense. The Gemara say, כל מה שסתום נפתח, כל מה שפתוח נסתם. So once he took his head out, that's it, cannot kill him. That's it, he has his own life. Now you have to deliver him. If she died, she died. What can you do? Do you understand what's going on here? So it's possible to say that in Egypt they didn't have this rule. Maybe the Egyptian in their constitution, they had a rule, as long as the entire baby didn't come out, is not considered yet that he's a brand new human being, because he's still connected to his mother body. Only after he came completely out, then you cannot kill him. But as long as he's half in, half out, you're still allowed to kill him. Now you know what he is, a boy or a girl. You can see, you can check. Why? Still connected. That's why when they came and say to him, they were already out completely, he should have answered to them, what do I care? I told you to kill them. Why didn't you kill him? Kill him inside or outside, who cares? No. He couldn't say anything. Otherwise, there's no way to understand this parasha. No way to understand this parasha. No way. Try any possibility you can, you're not going to understand anything. This is all a fight about abortion in the Torah. I want to ask you another question. Why Paro only called the Jewish midwives? There's many goyot. Fatma, Saida, all of you come. I give you a speech now. All the Jewish boys that are about to be born, go and kill them. Why he needs to call the only two Jewish ones? Which is really one and a half. The other one is a little girl. And why, but what do you think, that the Jewish nation that were giving birth to six in one shot, that two maids were enough for a million people? You know how many deliveries you had every day? What happened if you have 30 deliveries now? And they are in one house. Remember, there's no cars. They have to go to another car on a donkey, to another house on a donkey. It will take 2 hours. And someone is screaming, ah, help! No, wait, wait. There's no telephone, no nothing. Someone has to run to their house. They're not home. Where are they? There's no way to locate them. FBI doesn't have a tracking device. So how are they going to deliver 30 deliveries in one day? If they have hours to go from one place to another, it's not possible. Has to be 100 at least. What is going on here? Why he goes to the Jews to tell them to kill Jewish babies? Much easier to go to the Goyot. Anyway, the many of them hates. I want volunteers to help me to exterminate the Jewish boys. They will have hundreds coming. Just pay them a nice salary, give them a raise, and they'll do it. Why would they call only the two midwives to tell them to kill? And why he only wants to kill the boys and not the girls? And why he needs to kill them? Just throw them out of the country. Make a law. You are not legal citizen from now on, like Trump did with his Muslims. You cannot come to this country anymore. I'm canceling green cards of some of you. Go back to your country. We don't want you here. Soon the Germans are going to do the same thing to Turkish. What do you think? Or to Algerian or Moroccans. They flooded all over the area. They're not going to have a choice. It's either us or them with all these human rights, liberal, lefty, democratic laws. They're going to be forced to change it. Otherwise, they'll be all dead. Very soon that all Europeans will be dead. It's a matter of 10 to 20 years. That's it. Once they gain the power in a country, they slaughter all of them. I don't have to tell you what's going to happen. They're all with the constant brainwash of the Islam in YouTube, every day, non-stop. Once they gain the power, and they also get elected in a government, and they'll become the majority, Europeans are all dead. The Europeans killed the Jews, Hashem sent them the monsters to take care of them. I didn't say it. One Spanish intellectual wrote the letter. You saw it? We killed the Jews, the light of the world, the intelligence of the world, that they contributed more than anyone to the world. God punished us, sent us these barbarian murderers. Spanish writer. You saw that letter or no? It was all over Facebook, YouTube. You know, I just want to finish this. Why Judah got the blessing from Yaakov? No one should sit on your chair until Mashiach comes. It has to be from your family. In the meantime, we can put temporary kings. But when the time comes, immediately you move him from his chair and give it to the king of Mashiach from Shevet Yehuda. What is the merit of Yehuda that he got such a blessing in the Torah from Yaakov? Yehuda was the fourth son of Yaakov. There are three more important ones than him, older than him. Why would it be the one that we are named after him, Jewish, Yehudim? We are named after Yehuda. Why not Shimonim, Reuvenim? What's so special about him? The answer is Gur Aryeh Yehuda Miterev Bnei Elit. Rashi writes, Bnei Elit. What's Bnei Elit? People that raised above the average. סילקת את עצמך ואמרת מה בצע. יהודה say, why should we kill him? Yosef was in a pit. Why should we kill him? He wanted to save him. And then when they wanted to kill Tamar, and she said, you recognize this stamp and this cane? Right away he admitted, I made a sin with her. Leave her. All the trial is a mistrial. Don't kill her. The verdict that I say, it's based on wrong information. Let her go. You, your majesty, your honor. Imagine you go to court, and in the middle of the trial, the judge said death sentence to the defendant, and the defendant pulled some documents, and everybody see, he's blaming the judge for being with him in the time of the crime. The judge has two options. One to say it's crazy, don't even waste time on him, just kill him. No psychiatrist, no nothing. And then no one will ever know the truth. Or the judge can say, I'm sorry, give me back. The verdict is right. I was together with him in a crime. To admit to the whole world. It's not easy. Believe me, it's not easy. Sometimes it's easier to let an innocent person die than to embarrass and humiliate yourself in front of the whole world. Do you know how I can prove it to you? How many people prefer to die in a history than not to get a huge embarrassment in the public? Do you know how many people in Israel committed suicide because wicked, rotten journalists found out a big secret about them and they were about to publish it and they begged them, please, you kill me, you kill my, I'm going to be embarrassed in the whole world. Don't publish it. And they didn't care and they jumped from the window and killed themselves many times. I rather kill myself than get the embarrassment. So if I rather kill myself and not to be embarrassed, I rather kill someone as a stranger than be embarrassed. Much easier, right? If I rather die not to get an embarrassment, what's easier, to kill myself or to kill a stranger? Kill a stranger. So Yehuda should have said, just kill him. She used to be my daughter-in-law. She's crazy. Kill her. I want to ask you a question. Whenever you have an argument with another person, it's very rare that he admits that you are right and he's wrong, right? You know that people don't want to admit. When finally people admit that you won the argument, how do they do it? What are the words that they use? What words you, when you lose an argument to someone, he proved to you that you were wrong. What? You're right, right? Very good. You don't say, I am wrong. You say, you are right. There's a very big difference. It's very hard for a person to say the words, I was wrong, I am wrong. It's much easier for him to say, you are right. Why? Everybody, you're right, you're right. They don't say, I'm wrong, I'm wrong. Why is it? Ego. It's all about ego. When I'm saying you are right, that means, but I'm not totally wrong. I'm also right. That's come from the subconscious. But when you say I'm wrong, that means you made yourself look like a loser. Ugh, look at me, I'm a zero, I'm nobody. I lost. Very hard. Yehuda said, Tzadka mimeni. Even Yehuda couldn't say I was wrong. He said, she's right. But in this situation, the embarrassment was so huge. Thanks to that, he got the blessing. You deserve to be a king for eternity. And the nation of Israel will be called after you, Yehudim. Otherwise, our name would be Ivrim. Like in the time of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. There was no Yehudim yet. When we became Yehudim, after Yehuda. Chazal said, Chazal say, it says like this. HaKadosh Baruch Hu made him a president, a king. Because he was able, although he had a lot of embarrassment, to embarrass himself in front of the whole world. And this is the words of the Malbim. The Malbim say, Achia Shiloni, in the time of the kings. He spoke to Yerovam, the wicked king. Yerovam. He said to him, V'otcha ekach, I will take you. U'malachta bechol asher te'aven afshecha. You will king everywhere you desire to rule. You name it. No. The prophet tells you such a thing. V'ayita melech al Israel. You will be a king over the nation of Israel. Why do you need a duplication of what he says? He said to him, you will be a king in every place you choose. And after that he repeated and he said, V'ayita melech al Israel. And you will be a king on the nation of Israel. Why? You already told me I can be a king anywhere I want. Of course I want to be a king of the nation of Israel. Why you have to repeat it again? That's a condition for kingdom. Before you rule over the nation, first you have to be a king over yourself. You cannot be a rotten human being, politically correct, faker, deceiver, low politician, and try to be a good king. It's not going to work. First, work on yourself, be righteous, be strong, don't be lazy, don't be a liar, don't be a show-off. Don't be a selfish person. Have mercy. Stick to the highest level of truth. Then you are worthy to be the king of the nation of Israel. First, be a king on yourself. Anyone here can raise his name and his hand and say, I am ruling my desires. I win, always. The answer is, none of us can do it. And usually it's 99%, the Satan will say, I rule over you, my friend. Keep dreaming. I decide where you smoke. I decide when you do drugs. I decide when you break Shabbat. I decide when you go to the woman to make scenes. I decide everything. And you always fall. I play the flute, and you dance according to my music. And don't ever think it's the other way around. I play the music. True or false? 100% true. Im timloch bechol asher ta'ave nafshecha. What he really told him, if you will be a king in everything that you desire, meaning you'll be able to say, no, I'm not going to eat from it. It's not kosher. I'm not going to say it. It's going to hurt the other person. I'm not going to wake up at this time because it's disrespect. I will pray this amount of time. I won't look for shortcuts. I am a boss over my desire. Now, right away, I'll be happy to make you the king on Israel, of course. Why Moshe Rabbeinu became a king? He was stuttering. He was born by the Goy palace. Not exactly the type to be the king. He was a shepherd. He gave his life for the sheep, ran after them, took care of them, fed them. When one of them ran, he chased him. He cared about animals. Of course, he's going to care about this. Not like today in Israel. They care very much about animals. But when a religious Jew comes, right away they want to kill him with cold blood. Animals? Oh my God! You don't know what's going on in Israel. You can now walk in one street in Israel without seeing 20, 30 dogs. I never saw in my life such thing. I go every few months. I walked in the street, every other person with dogs, 2, 3, 1, 4. Dogs' waste is all over, of course, because some people don't clean. The street became a zoo. You have no idea, barking from all over. I sit by my parents' terrace every second. How, everywhere. What's going on? Became a zoo. Why people are so crazy about dogs? It's not a good sign. If you're so anxious to be with dogs, check yourself very carefully. A very high-level righteous person cannot even be in the same room with a dog. If the dog touches him, he faints. Why? Because the dog is the filthiest animal spiritually from 2 million different kinds of animals. It's written in the Torah. The Torah say, if you have a pig and you sold the pig, you got, let's say, $1,000. Now you want to take this $1,000 and you buy a sheep or two of them and you come and sacrifice it to Bet HaMikdash. Allowed or not allowed? You replace the pig with cash and now you buy kosher sheep and you bring it to Bet HaMikdash. Allowed. If you sold the cobra snake, allowed. If you sold the lion, allowed. Sold the horse, allowed. Sold the donkey, allowed. Giraffe, allowed. Everything is allowed. You sold a dog, nice, cute, blue eyes. You know, this is a German Shepherd. $5,000 dog. You went, you sold it, you bought 10 sheep, and you want to sacrifice it on the altar in Bet HaMikdash. Not allowed. The value of the dog cannot come on the altar. Two things cannot be sacrificed to me, God said. What you gave to a prostitute as making a sin with her, whatever the value of it, if you replace it with something else, it's non-zona, you cannot bring me to Bet HaMikdash. Act of prostitution, I cannot look at you. And if you sold a dog, and you took the money of the filthy dog, and you bring it to Bet HaMikdash in a sheep form, I cannot accept it. Why? Dogs are the best friends of the human being, no? Sometimes they die for us. Don't make that mistake that everyone does. I'm not talking about the dogs physically. Physically, they are the best friends. Yes, they'll die for you. They guard your house. They'll save your children from drowning in a pool. They do a lot of, they smell drugs. They do terrorism. Look in the airport. They walk with them. They're very helpful. But spiritually, they are in the lowest spiritual level. The worst reincarnations of the most wicked people in the histories are in dogs. Remember this. When Hashem wants really to punish someone, he takes his Jewish soul and attach it to the nefesh of the dog. My aunt in Israel, I can give you her information. Go and ask her. She lives in Yerushalayim. She had a dog named Billy. In Israel, all the dogs are Americans. They all have Steve, Billy, whatever. This Billy was a black, curly little dog. She swore to me, 5 days a year, Billy refused to eat. Every day I put his food in front of him. Every hour or two he comes, he eats. 5 days a year. No matter how much food and water I put in front of him, he refused to eat and drink. The 5 days of the fast in a Jewish calendar, Billy refused to eat. Reincarnation of a Jew that used to eat in the fast days. Now his tikkun came back in a dog. He used to be a rabbi, Nisim Yagen, Alav HaShalom. He passed away many years from cancer. He was very, very strong speaker. Fire. If you think I'm strict, multiply it by 100. No jokes. Not that many people can hear such level of Musar. He made a lot of Baalei Tshuva. Many, many, many. No, he was from Israel. He used to come from time to time to Queens. Like, but he lived in the original Rav Nissim Yagen, Alav HaShalom. So he told a story. That's one of the stories who shook me so much. He said that he came one time to Queens from Israel. They told him, Rabbi, do you want to go and give a lecture in New Jersey? One young man had a car accident and he died. The family sit Shiva. There's over 100 chilonim over there. Do you want to come? You give a lecture, there's 100 secular people. Of course I want to come. Take me. They took him to a nice house in New Jersey somewhere. He walked in, started to give them Divrei Torah. In the middle, when he's there, they hear on the door scratching of nails on the door. They open the door. Huge black dog like this, very scary, standing by the door and one scream, close the door. It's the way they close the door. But they're constantly grinding on the door. What's going on here? He said to them, open the door. Open, don't be afraid, open. They open the door. The dog walk in, sadly. From all the places he came, there was one couch, single couch. He came and he sat on the couch. Don't move. Sit on the couch. Everyone looks at him. They got the shock of their life. He said to the parents, imagine if today he would say it, they'll crush him all over the internet. Baruch Hashem, there's no internet back then, 20-something years ago, like today. No Facebook, no liberal reporters that waiting what the rabbi will say that we can murder him tomorrow online. These things did not exist yet. He asked the parents, your son, Alav HaShalom, used to sit on this couch a lot? They said that was his favorite couch. All the time was sitting here watching TV. He said to them, here is your son. Came back in this reincarnation. Then he asked them, did your son has a girlfriend that was not Jewish? Say yes. At the time he died, he had a girlfriend not Jewish. So that's the reason he's a dog now. Chazar beGilgul. He told the story, it's on tape. Everybody knows what place, back then, everyone knew what house he's talking about. It was a tragedy in a community.
Why
there's other animals.
Why are those like
one of the reasons, dogs made a sin already in Noah's ark, so they are cursed. There's not only dogs are cursed, ravens also, the crow and the snake, as you can see in the Torah. There's few cursed animals. The Hashem said to the animals, no one is allowed to have relation until you come out of the ark. There's no room to multiply. And the dogs did not listen to Hashem. Even though it's a natural reaction, the animals have desires. But when Hashem interfered in a miracle way to give the dogs and the animals instruction, and who did it? The dogs. From all the animals, the dogs chose to do it. And also, you know, it's very interesting that the war sex crimes, if you read in a Zohar, in Ereshit Chochmah, comes back in dogs. Sex crimes usually goes by dogs. It's very interesting. Dogs, rabbits, ox, bulls, but mainly dogs, gays, things like this. Read in Shara Gilgulim of the Ari HaKadosh. I did not write Zohar and I did not write Kabbalah. All you have to do is take the book of the Ari HaKadosh and read Shar HaGilgulim. It tells you from what sins you come back in what animals. Nachon? But they have desire. All animals have natural desires, like us. We have two kinds of Yetzer Hara. The one that is natural and the one is external. I'll give you an example. If I was born with very big appetite, everything I see I want to attack. Food, meat, fish, all the time. If there's no food around me, I can still control my desire. As soon as I smell steak, restaurant, immediately I run in. The external Yetzer Hara just got a date with the natural Yetzer Hara, and together they execute a sin. Person that is all day women. You put him in Israeli army in what we call Tironut. I say Tironut in English. When what? Boot camp. When you just join the army. No women, no nothing. You're isolated in the end of the world. You're fighting all day. You're running. No time for sins. Your mind is not there. As soon as you come home after 3-4 weeks, wow, Shabbat, the beach. Immediately, the natural Yetzer Hara join with the external desire, Yetzer Hara, and they make a party. You understand how it goes? So again, what I'm saying to you is, do you have natural habits? If Hashem come and say to you, I know you're very hungry, don't eat. You can say, okay, and don't eat. And you can eat anyway. You understand? That's it. Same thing, the snake. The snake, what kind of Yetzer Hara I had? You know what Yetzer Hara I had? Snakes desire women. Did you know that? The Gemara say, a woman that see a snake chasing her, imagine you go to Costa Rica now, the rainforest, you see those 10-meter snakes, thick like this. They come on a tree, Hashem Yirachem, they crawl faster than a car. Some of them, you know how fast they move? That's what are you going to do now? A woman. A man and a woman is there. Who is in a much bigger danger? The woman. Okay. If there's no woman, then the man is in a danger. If there's a woman, his eyes is on a woman, not on a man. So what is the woman going to do now? She cannot run. You can chase her. So what is she going to do? If she has a jacket or one of the clothes that she's wearing, she throw it on the floor. Immediately he comes, because it goes by smell. You know, snakes goes by smell. She run. She throw it on the floor and begins to run. So when he comes down, automatically he goes to the smell of a woman, because Hashem made it the sickness of the snakes, that they desire women. Do you know what the sin of the snake and Eve was really? The sin, everyone thinks that the Christian thing, oh, the snake gave her an apple, and she said, thank you, muchas gracias, mwah, delicious. That's why apple has a beaten apple. But it wasn't the apple. It's a, that was an apple, it was grapes. That's besides the point. If somebody Jewish will invent a new company, put grapes and take some grapes out. That should be the new symbol, if you want to be accurate. But what was the real sin? The snake wanted to have relation with the woman. Nachash HaKadmoni, he had hands, legs. Mamash desire a woman. And then he put his poison into the woman. And this poison stay in human being forever. And the Gemara say the Jewish people lost the effect of that poison the day they got the Torah. Ha'eres shel ha'nachash ha'kadmoni. So Kabbalistic, they actually had relation. That's really what happened here. That's the whole reason he came to instigate between her and Adam. He was jealous. So the Gemara say, if a woman is chased by a snake and she cannot have throwing clothes or anything like that, she should run into the water. Once she runs into the water, they come to the water, they cannot smell anymore. So you're safe. Even you walk a few steps into the water, that's it. They cannot smell where you are. So they don't see. What happened when you go to sleep in the old days? It wasn't like today. Today the house are secure, window, this, that. In the old days, everything was sand. You live in tents, you live in cabins. They come from the windows, from the roof. They come to attack people. They put poison inside the drinks. That's why we have halacha. When you go to sleep, you got to cover whatever water or liquid you have to put a cover on it. Even though today it doesn't apply anymore, meaning no snakes will come into your Fifth Avenue mansion and put poison in your tea, right? But that's halacha. We don't change halachot. We're not reform. Reform, they do whatever they want. We follow the laws, even if it doesn't apply anymore. Because we know once we begin to cancel one law, two, three, that's the end of us. In two, three generations, our children and grandchildren will change everything. Once you already has a precedent that you're already starting to change the divine laws, that's the end of us. In two generations, what happened to the reform will happen to us. That's why we're very careful. Look at the Hasidish people. The Hasidish people, you kill them, he won't change his Hasidic laws. The righteous one. You tell him, I'll give you $1 million. Mendel, come. I'll give you $1 million. Don't wear this Hasidic clothes. Here, regular suit. Dress normal. Trim your beard. Enough with this fairy hat. Enough with this black hat. Put some Bukharian yarmulke with colors. $1 million cash. He won't do it. It's the end of him. No one would look at him in a community. If he comes in a different clothes, if you ask the Hasidim why it's so important, why it's so important to you to dress in Arizona with a fair hat in 110 degrees? Because they say to you, if I'm beginning to change the custom of my father and grandfather and all of that, in two generations all my children will be goyim. And the proof that they give you is from Egypt. The Gemara say, what was special about the Jewish nation in slavery in Egypt? They did not change their names, and they did not change their clothing. Meaning the Jewish people had a special clothes that they used to wear. I don't know what it was. But obviously it was different than the Goyim. So no matter what happened, they did not want to change the tradition of Yaakov and Yitzchak and Avraham and the tribes and everyone else. No, so wait. So because they didn't want to change it, Paro got panicked. Paro said, We have a nation that live among us and they're growing like crazy. Similar to what's happening today in Europe with the Muslims. They grow to 50 million already, all over the countries in Europe. They don't know what to do anymore. The European has one or two kids and three dogs and cats. And every Abdallah has between 8 and 16 kids. So they already understand the European in 20 years all over Europe will be Muslims. We'll all be dead. We're going to have to run out of here to Mexico, New Zealand, somewhere. Imagine the French people would have to leave Paris and all the glorious French into the hand of these Muslims and leave France. You know, for them, they'd rather die than not to do. Or the British, or the Germans. This is nations that are over 1,000 years sitting on their land, not 1 or 2 days. It's over 1,000 years. Germans are more than 1,000 years sitting there in Germany. You understand? So what's going to happen? They get panic. So they want to make rules of immigration. What's wrong about it? It's correct or not correct? 100% correct. There is a nation who came into your country and they declare they want to kill you and they multiply like crazy and in 20 years you and your children will all be dead. It's very clear. So every rational law says I have to protect me and my children more than I protect these strangers. If a guest comes into my living room with a knife and wants to kill me, what do I do? Push him out of the terrace before he killed me and my children. No one will ever complain about me, right? Self-defense. Not racism, nothing. No prejudice, none of this nonsense. You came into my living room, want to kill me, or into my bedroom, you're not hiding it, no problem. I have the right to defend myself. I don't want to kill you, but I want to throw you out of my house. Fair enough or no? So what's the problem? Why Hashem is so angry at the Egyptians and Pharaoh? They did what the king's supposed to do. If I'm the king of Egypt, and I have a nation living here, and in 2-3 generations they already have hundreds of thousands of people, and they moved all over Egypt, every building, every street, now you have them. Until now, they were all in Goshen. So if they become 1 million people, I don't care, I make a wall. I'll make a wall and they pay for the wall. Like Trump. Right? So Paro say, no problem. I'll make a wall. You are guest in my country. I'm giving you Goshen. Stay there. Now you want to come into my country? You need a passport. But when the Jews moved to Egypt and they were all rich, don't forget, they got all the wealth in the world. They're the family of the treasury, Yosef. And when all the people in the world came to sell everything they had, all the real estate, because they needed food, who bought it? All the Jewish people. They bought it. So what happened? They became very wealthy. They started to buy real estate all over Egypt. They speak different language. They dress different, like Hasidish, let's say, among all kinds of goyim in Texas and Chicago and everywhere else. They started to go crazy. So listen, they are everywhere now. Soon, they will become the king. And they'll kick us out of the country. Or if it's going to be a war, they will join our enemy. They'll make an agreement. They will give them secrets of what's happening in Egypt. They join together with our enemies and they'll kill us all. 100% correct. What do you want? What do you want from them? Self-defense. We have cancer growing in our country. So why Hashem got so angry at them? Why Hashem is so angry at them that he destroyed them like this?
Went too far.
Okay. Answer number one. Hashem cannot stand ungrateful people. You already forgot that one generation ago you were all supposed to die from starvation. Who gave you life? Their father, Yosef. Without him, you all be dead. You were already dead. He saved all of you. You became the richest country in the world thanks to him. One generation later, you want to kill his children and make them slaves? Take their rights away? That's one problem. If they would tell the Jews, take money, take wealth, take all your real estate, sell it, and move out of our country. I'm not going to touch you. We're not going to kill you. Just go. Leave. You have 1 year to leave. Maybe Hashem wouldn't do anything to them. Why? It's legitimate. They're afraid that Israel will take over Egypt. It's their country. They don't want to lose it. I don't think Hashem would do what he did to them. But they didn't choose that option. They chose to torture them and make them slaves and destroy them mentally. They didn't just give them jobs. They gave the ladies construction work, which is very hard for them. And they gave the men women's jobs. Kneading, sewing. They destroyed them mentally. So you see, it's not that because we want you to build Egypt. No. We want to destroy you mentally, meaning we are sadistic. We enjoy to torture you. Not because we're afraid that you're going to take over our country. If we're afraid that you take over our country, we have other rules. We either evict you, we give you your money, your rights, leave. Or we ask you to go to Goshen and we make a wall and that's the end of it. It's two different countries. Or if we want to make you slaves, at least let's give each one of you a job that he can handle, not destroy mentally. And we will allow you to have children. No, but we have to kill all your children because we're afraid that you're going to multiply here and kill us. So let me ask you a question. If that's the case, why do you only want to kill the men? Why not the women? If you want to kill a nation, Hitler, did he care men or women? He wanted to kill everybody. Children, women, Aman, he wanted to kill everybody. Why Paro was such a snake that he wants to kill only the men? The answer is, Paro is afraid of one thing. Now when we got used to them, and they are already free slaves, we cannot live without them. Wonderful life. Yosef, clean the bathroom. Abraham, clean the shower. Yitzchak, cut the grass. Very nice life. Built for us, make roads, make the pyramids. How can we live without such comfortable life? Free slaves everywhere. Some Israelis, they went overseas in high tech, or they were very big generals in the army, so they have a lot of security knowledge. They went to country like Namibia, all these African countries. You have to see the way they live. They live in mansions with pools, 10 slaves. Everyone do everything for them. They live like kings. Why? $10,000, you live like a king. Here in Brooklyn, $10,000, you're homeless. Homeless. Not enough to pay the yeshivot of your children even. But in those countries, you live like a king. My mother told me when I was a little girl in Iran, we had a house that it would take you an hour to walk on a property. An hour with a pool, with Iranian servants. They used to wash my legs as a little Persian girl. I'm talking to you 70 years ago. They used to wash my legs before I go to sleep because it was, you know, in the old days, it wasn't like today, showers. You had to, the Jews were kings. You see, in the history of the world, you will never find any Jewish woman that was a slave or a maid in any Arab or Muslim house. But in all the Jewish homes, they always have Arab maids and slaves all over the Middle East. But never a Jewish girl worked for an Arab rich man. Never. In Europe also? I don't know about Europe, but in why is it? Do you know why? Because the Torah say, Hashem said to Hagar, go back to Sarah and let her be your boss and work for her. It's written in the Torah, Ma'ase avot siman lebanim. The Torah say, your father and his father, your father was the boss and he was the servant, that's it. It's a rule forever. The Torah say, Ishmael, Pere, Adam, wild beast, forever. The Torah say, Esav will live by sword, forever. The Crusades, all this Roman Empire, the Greeks, all of them children of Esav, always swords. Whatever the Torah say, forever. So now, where is the water? Oh, I feel that I'm becoming sick. What can I do? Can I make bracha? No. ברוך אתה אדוני אלוהינו מלך העולם שהכל נהיה בדברו. Time ran out. Why Paro wants to kill only the boy? Because Paro already knew that the Jews have tradition that one day we come out of Egypt, whether you like it or not, we go to the promised land and we build the temple and we're going to serve God as Kohanim and Leviim. Kohanim and Leviim goes by the father, right? So Paro said, if I'll kill all the men in one generation, then they're all going to marry Goyim, all the Egyptians. So they will never be Kohanim and Leviim, never. So they don't have Kohanim and Leviim. That means Mashiach will never come, and there will never be a temple, and they will stay here forever as slaves. And we can do whatever we want with them. When we want to kill them, we'll kill them. We keep some of them as slaves. No problem. That's why when Shifra and Pua, they risk their life not to kill the boys, it's written in the Torah, Hashem made them homes. Bana lahem batim. Rashi writes, Batei kehuna uvatei leviya. What's the connection? The Torah says Hashem made them houses. Rashi says, houses of Kohanim and house of Leviim. Meaning, you saved the Jewish boys because you knew if you're not going to have Jewish boys, there will never be Kohanim and Leviim. You cut the heritage. You cut it. You're going to have the Kohanim and the Leviim come from you. Moshe and Aaron, from you. Hashem could have chose someone else. They didn't have to be Moshe. Huh? No, from Yocheved. Yocheved, right. Huh?
They didn't do the
chit
egel, so it's
no one bechor
the kahuna.
Who did the Shevet Levi?
The kahuna was the bechor back then, no? Bechor would be the kahanim.
Yes.
Just like we have
by right.
Then they did the chit egel in the desert, so Hashem
did bechor. No, but here we're talking even before chit egel. Rashi tells you this was way before chit egel. Chit egel will be later, many years later.
Sure, so you're trying to kill the kahanim and the
So that's why Hashem says everything in life that you do for others, including risking your life, you not did it for Him. You only do it for yourself. Just wait and see. That's what it is. Look at this story I told before, this Israeli guy in Queens. $940 million went into his account by mistake. $940,000. And he sent it all back. And he didn't have to even according to the law. But he wanted to be fully honest and clean hands. What happened? He made already 10 times more and it's just the beginning. Nobody can ever lose by listening to Hashem. You know, I got an email about 3 weeks ago. One guy told me, Rabbi, I have a question. Listen to this. He said, until now, for about a year, I did not work. I came to a situation that I basically have no money at all, nothing left. All of a sudden, every day I'm getting deposits into my checking account by an anonymous person. I don't know. Every day I get deposits. Is it Hashem saving me that I can continue to learn Torah? What should I do? Should I go to the bank? Should I tell the bank you're putting money in my account by mistake? I told him, don't be so happy. Soon the bank gonna have, they have their own audits. They check what's missing. They make an investigation. They'll come back to you. Don't worry. But hard to believe that in these days, the banks still make such mistakes. Or maybe people make mistakes in a bank account number. Somebody gave them a bank account number. They missed a digit or something. They're depositing into a different account. One day they wake up, they already put thousands of dollars there. Who knows? Who knows? Now I want to finish. I want to finish the lecture. I didn't even start talking about Sefer Shmot. It's unbelievable. I'm still in the introduction of this lecture. But I know I have to send you home. I just want to talk about something that makes the community here in Brooklyn very happy recently. I need him to be up if you can, because I want to hear his opinion. Doctor, good morning. Until now I let you rest. Now I need you. Please try to be up for the next 5 minutes before we finished. Now, I got 50 videos from Jews, almost all religious Jews, basically all religious, very excited. They feel so proud. Religious people from Borough Park, from Flatbush, they so proud. What? And it's not Rubashkin. Okay? It was even before Rubashkin came out. They're very proud. Why? They had a 2 or 3 minutes clip from the television here in America, in New York. Finally, the Mashiach came. No. The Mashiach didn't come. Something even better in their eyes happened. Finally, the court, the criminal court of New York, has a Hasidish woman as a judge. I'm seeing these comments of the people, Bamash, I had tears in my eyes. I say, Hashem, look how foolish we became. Religious people, Hasidish, that grew up in yeshivot, Litvish, children of big rabbis, people who went to yeshivot, zero knowledge in Judaism, zero knowledge. Instead of crying that a Jewish religious person became a judge in a non-Jewish court, that almost all the laws there is a war against Hashem, and sentencing people against the Torah every day. And many of them are Jews, sending them to prison when the Torah said they're not guilty. Taking their money away when the Torah said they did nothing wrong. And even if they follow the law of United States, Din and the Malchuta, what is it, if the laws of United States goes against the law of the Torah? In United States is allowed to make an abortion. You're allowed to, as a Jewish doctor, you're allowed to make an abortion? Din and the Malchuta! That's stupid, Din and the Malchuta. You have to sit in jail all your life and not to kill one baby. Why, do you have permission to kill baby because the United States allow it? Or the other way around. You're going to send a Jewish person into the jail for buying stocks that someone told him to buy a week before. Buy this company, it's going to go up, I know. My uncle worked there. He told me soon they're going to make a lot of money. So you went and bought some stocks, you made some money, FBI came, put you in jail, took away your home, froze your account, put you 6 years in prison, like a rapist. Why? Because you made a few thousand dollars buying stocks. And who is your judge? A religious Jew. She has to send you now to jail because she has to follow the Constitution. So she's sentencing you to jail and to kill your family because she wants to be a judge in the United States? When in the Torah you're totally innocent. Could be a very big rabbi, important to the world, to the Jewish nation. She has no choice. What is she going to say in the court? I'm sorry, I'm religious. I have a problem sending this rabbi to jail because based on the law of the United States, maybe he broke the law, but according to the Torah, he did nothing wrong. They tell her, get lost. Who cares about your Torah? You came to represent the United States, not the Torah. But you know what got me the most upset? The one Chabadnik were making a comment, fighting with other people that there is already a Chabadnik judge in L.A. She's not the first. They're fighting. Instead of being embarrassed and hide themselves, all this community here that have no understanding about simple laws of the Torah, instead of crying and begging Hashem, please forgive us for this Chilul Hashem that came from our community. We are so embarrassed. So I'm telling you, I don't have anything against her. I don't know who she is. I don't know anything about her. All I heard that she is a religious woman. That's why I'm upset. If she wasn't religious, I understand. They don't know Torah, nothing. But if you come from a Hasidish family, the Hasidim are strict when it comes to Torah. They don't just destroy the Torah and everything. So now I want to ask, where is all the rabbis in Brooklyn here? How can nobody make a beep? It's one of the biggest crimes against the Torah. Let me explain in case you don't understand. According to the Torah, if you sue another Jew in a not rabbinical Torah law court, you already such a criminal that you cannot be a part of the minyan anymore. You call a moser, you a trader, you're not allowed to sue any Jew in a non-religious orthodox bedin. And if he doesn't want to come, the bedin will give you permission to take him to a non-Jewish court. Only after the rabbis in the bedin gave you permission, then it's not a sin. But the first priority, you must take him to a rabbinical Jewish law. Rabbis, he owe me money. Here is the papers, he doesn't pay me. The rabbi check and they make the verdict. If he doesn't pay, then you can take the verdict of the Beit Din. It's recognized in the United States as a legal arbitration. You can go to anyone, not necessarily to rabbis. According to United States, you can go to your grandpa. You and your friend, you have a grandpa. You're fighting over money. You come to your grandpa and say, "Grandpa, judge who is right." So the grandpa say, "Okay, sign this paper that you nominate me to be an arbitrator." And you both sign that you agree that he will be the arbitrator. And he say, "Reuven or Shimon, $10,000. And now Reuven doesn't want to pay. Shimon can take this paper from the grandpa and go to the Beit Din and say to the court here in Manhattan and say, "Look, we signed an arbitration." They bring this grandpa to testify. "Yes, I was the judge and I found..." You sign that you agree that he will be the judge. You must give the money according to the law of the United States. That's called arbitration. So the Beit Din, the worst case scenario, it's like arbitration. So if the guy that the Beit Din say you have to pay does not want to pay, you go to the secular court in Israel or in New York, and they are forced, they loan him, they can send him the marshal, the sheriff, collection, everything like it was decided in United States court. Now, if you're not allowed to even step into a secular court, you're not allowed to put mezuzot there, do you know that? You're not allowed to put mezuzah in the Israeli court. A rabbi that will put mezuzah in the Israeli court, Hashem will chop his hand off. It's a very big sin. You're not allowed to put mezuzah in a prostitution home. You're not allowed to put mezuzah in a church. You're not allowed to put mezuzah in a place they sell pigs. And you're not allowed to put mezuzah in a secular Israeli court that they call themselves Jewish and they follow the laws of the goyim. You're not allowed to put mezuzah. They want to put mezuzah, it's their problem. But if they call you as an Orthodox rabbi, "We want you to put mezuzot in all the Beit HaMishpat in Be'er Sheva or in Tel Aviv," you're not allowed to go. It's a very big chilul Hashem. You're not allowed to put mezuzah over there. You have a prostitution home that guys come to make scenes with the girls. You put mezuzot over there? Chas v'shalom. It's a very big chilul Hashem. They want to put mezuzot, it's their problem. And you're not allowed to put it for them. Do you know what punishment Hashem will give this kind of people that they do these kinds of things? So now, if you're not allowed to sue even one time a Jew in court, you're allowed to be a judge there? Being a criminal judge, you represent the government of the United States. You can send people to prison or to sometimes to death sentence. Maybe not in New York, but in New Jersey they have death penalty. Whatever the law of the United States says, the judge doesn't make the rules. The judge knows. For rape, they have to give between X amount of years to X amount of years. The judge can decide if to give a rapist 5 years or 30 years. Whatever the law is allowed, but the judge cannot give them less or more than what the law says. So the judge decides minimum and maximum, but he cannot go below the minimum or above the maximum. But a judge is deciding if to give you only 3 years in prison or 10. It's your decision. Now, for every extra year that a person sits in jail and according to the law is innocent, who do you think has to pay for it? The judge. The judge will be held responsible for every innocent Jew according to the Torah innocent that is sitting in jail or they took away his money. And according to the Torah, he's not guilty, according to the Torah. And a religious Jew, someone with yarmulke on his head, you know, in Israel, you have a lot of them. Not Hasidish and not very, very religious, but they have very modern judges with yarmulke on their head, sitting in Israel in a court, a lot of them. Actually, the judges that actually sentenced Yigal Amir, the murderer of Yitzhak Rabin, one of them had a yarmulke. One of them was a religious Jew. So you have to understand one thing. As one thing, you want to be a criminal lawyer. Before you become a judge, sometimes you have to be first a lawyer. So now, are you allowed to be a criminal lawyer or no? Technically, no. What? The same thing. I have to go to go by the rules of United States Goyim, and it's nothing to do with the Torah. But some says, if you're only going to be a criminal lawyer to protect Jews from the law of the country, protect them. Somebody wants him to sit in jail, like Rubashkin. He needed a real lawyer that he can trust, someone from the community, so he found one religious guy. It's much better that you know your lawyer, understand your culture and where you come from, and Shabbat, and halacha, and kosher food. So the lawyer can come and protect you from the laws that wants to put you forever in jail because they're anti-Semite or whatever the case. So to be a criminal defense lawyer, some say it's allowed. But definitely no one agree that you're allowed to be a prosecutor or a judge. There's no question about it. If you are a prosecutor, or if you sue a person in court of the Goyim or the Chilonim in Israel, or if you act as a judge, you cannot be a part of the minyan, nobody should marry your children, you cannot be part of the community, no one is allowed to say hello to you. That's a din of Moser. It's a person that mevaze Torah Hashem. And instead of screaming, how can it happen, something like this in our community? What a pride day. We're so proud. Finally, a Jewish religious one. And in Israel, you have to see, even worse than here. Many of the Israeli wrote, Bekarov etznenu, soon by us. Zero knowledge. You're not getting what I'm saying. I'm not saying they don't. You can mean well. They want to do well. They want to be fair judge. Let's say that this woman is the most honest woman in the world. Okay? Let's give her the benefits of the doubt. Let's say she means 100% to do justice. But what kind of justice she's going to do? Justice according to Goyim in America that wrote the Constitution who knows how many years ago. Not justice according to God. Justice, I give you one example. If a person hit his wife, he gave her a smack. It's a very bad thing to do. Everyone agree. Every rabbi will tell you, not allowed to do such thing. Come on, what's going on? You're an animal. But let's say the law in the United States would say that someone who gave a smack to his wife will sit in jail 5 years. And you are the judge, the Jewish judge. You have to send him 5 years to prison because maybe that's the law of the United States. I'm just making it up. According to the Torah, a husband that smacked his wife doesn't deserve to sit 5 years in prison. Hashem will give him a punishment. He is a criminal. He should control his anger and temper, of course. And maybe some rabbis will tell her, run away, get a get and divorce him. Yes. I'm not saying no. I always tell women, don't let them ever a man touch you. Give you one smack, that's basically the end of everything. You want to give him a second chance, it's up to you. But if it's violence, run for your life. But I'm still telling you, it doesn't mean he has to sit a few years in prison. I give you another example. In the court of America, a husband and wife got divorced. The wife wants to become chilonit, secular, mechalelet Shabbat. They have five Hasidish kids. The husband is a Hasid Jew in Kollel, yeshiva. And the wife decided to take off her cover. She doesn't cover the hair. She wore pants. She doesn't want to keep kosher. She doesn't want to keep Shabbat. And they go to court now. And they have a custody battle in the room of this woman. This woman will have to give custody to the woman. Why? In the United States, the woman comes before the man when it comes to the kids. Unless she's a drug addict or anything like this. They don't care she became a Chalel Shabbat. They don't care she eats shrimps. They don't care she eats on Yom Kippur. And they don't care that she wants to take them out of yeshiva and put them in public school. She's going to have to rule based on the United States, not based on the laws of the Torah. In the law of the Torah, if she goes to Beit Din, she gets nothing. She doesn't get ketubah. She doesn't get the house. She doesn't get custody of the children. She lost all her rights. But if she's going to go to the court in Brooklyn or Manhattan, whenever this woman is a judge, she's going to have to give custody to the woman. and rebel against Hashem and murder these Jewish kids. Who's going to save them from her? She cannot do whatever she wants. She has to do what United States law say. That's why you're not allowed to be a judge in a court of goyim. You're not allowed.
Her rabbi didn't tell her that to save her from death?
That's what I'm asking myself for the last month. Believe me, it doesn't give me rest. I don't...
She's going to be the least punishment. She's going to go as closest to the Torah that she can.
No. Let me give you an answer to what you say. He has a good point. He said, what's better? That there will be a goy there? A goy will give the Jew 20 years in prison. She will give him 4 years in prison. The minimum. Let me tell you the law. The law is, if you go, two Jews go to the court, and the judge there, the Israeli not religious judge, or religious judge, doesn't matter, following the laws of Israel, or the laws of United States, and he said that Reuven has to pay Shimon $20,000 fee. And this is exactly what the Jewish Beit Din will rule. Same thing. They would also say, you sign, you have to pay commission, $20,000. If you went to the court in Manhattan, and this Hasidic woman ruled that you pay him $20,000, and that's exactly what the Torah say. When he received the $20,000, is 100% stealing. He cannot take the money. He has to give the money back. Because it wasn't reached based on the rules of the Torah. Even if it came to the same verdict, it's still not a kosher verdict, it's pasul. You're not allowed to take the money. Did you know that? If you rule the same exact thing like the Torah, not something close to the Torah, the same exact thing, if you could, it's still not a kosher verdict. You're not allowed to accept it. Because you make the court that are not divine, you make them important. You understand? That's why you're not allowed to tell Christians on Christmas, Merry Christmas. You're not allowed to tell them that. You're not allowed to tell them Happy Holidays. Because by saying that, you give importance to their fake religion. You're not allowed to say it. You can say Happy New Year, thinking civil year. Nothing to do with religion. It's a new year, civil. It's nothing to do with the Torah. That's the maximum you can say. And better even not to say this. You're not allowed to tell him Happy Holidays. You're not allowed to give him a gift on Christmas Day. You can give them a gift for something else, a week later, something.
Why?
I give you a gift for the new civil year. Nothing to do with Christianity. If you give him a gift on Christmas Day or the day before, meaning that it's clear that you give it to him for his fake holiday, you go against God. It means that you recognize their holidays as holidays. Like this fool who went to Target to dance around the Christmas tree. Remember that I saw? He said, are you afraid of the holidays? Why Jewish people afraid of Christmas? You're not even allowed to say those words. Holidays, he called it. Holidays mean holy days. Days that are holy. Holy, it's only from God. This religion did not come from God. You understand? Even Christians that are not religious, they're not allowed to say to their parents, Merry Christmas or Happy Holiday. They're not allowed. Because even the goyim are not allowed to follow fake religion. And even the goyim are not allowed to follow a religion of idol worshipping. So when Tony, that is not Christian, he doesn't believe in JC, he's a righteous Gentile. He doesn't kill, he doesn't steal, he believes in one God. He followed the rules of the Torah. I'm a goy, I have to keep the seven law. And he has a brother that is a devoted Christian. He's not allowed to send him a gift and tell him happy holidays. That's also breaking the rules of the Torah for the goyim. Because you're making a holiday of idol worshippers something important. And there's nothing that Hashem hates more than this. Hashem doesn't like fakers, he doesn't like liars, and he doesn't like fake prophets. And he doesn't like people who fake a religion. To write a book and claim that they got it from God. You understand? That is not allowed. You want to ask my opinion? It's a very foolish rule. That's my opinion. You have an obligation to learn Torah all the time. If you want to ask my opinion, and the night of the holiday, you have to learn Torah double. If you learn usually 2 hours, learn 10 hours. Why? For the destruction that came to the world. When we mourn something, right? That's something that happened. What's the best way to do elevation for the people that die? To learn Torah. They killed so many Jews, these people. Now we're not going to learn Torah because of the stupid fake holiday? What is the connection? I don't know. Ask the rabbis who made this law to play chess. I don't know where they got this idea from. I never understood this law. My opinion is totally, totally false. It's definitely not what Hashem wants. Tomorrow, if the Goyim will invent a holiday every day, that is against the Torah. So we'll stop learning Torah all year. Every day a new holiday. These Mormons made this day special. Special cult in Islam, this day is special. Chinese, this day is special. Why don't we stop learning Torah when the Chinese make all kinds of fake holidays for their gods? You know how many religions you have in India of idol worshippers? Basically, every week you have some kind of a holiday of Indians somewhere in the world, idol worshippers. So maybe we don't learn Torah also then. What is the connection? I don't understand. What does one have to do with the other? I'm not criticizing anyone. If big people made this rule, that's the problem to explain why. My humble opinion is totally false. And many, I heard Rav Ovadia Yosef also say it's totally false. Nonsense. You have to learn Torah more. Many rabbis say, Sfaradim and Ashkenazim, you have to learn even more this night. Why? You have to learn all the time. Every hour you learn Torah, it's 60,000 mitzvot. If you're a person that usually learn every night, and now you don't learn 10 hours because of this stupid holiday, you're going to give up 600,000 mitzvot because some guy invented a fake holiday? 600,000 mitzvot? What rabbi can take such a responsibility in his file to tell thousands of people not to learn Torah? I don't know. I don't know where it comes from. What difference does it make, Chatzot or not Chatzot? It's still Christmas. It's still a fake holiday. Huh? Don't ask me. I did not make rules. When rules are made and you have questions about them, you have to go to the people who made those rules. Not to me. I disagree with this rule and I don't follow this rule. You understand? Anyone will ask me, I'll tell him, learn non-stop. For a minute, don't stop. If his rabbi tell him not to learn, it's his rabbi's responsibility to explain why not. Not me. It's not my rule. You understand? If his rabbi decide, whatever, I don't know who, whoever decide not to learn that night, that's his responsibility to explain to Hashem why he made this rule. Maybe Hashem will agree with him. I don't know. Any questions before we finish? Yeah.
Last week you said you'll give us an answer to that.
What was the question? Remind me. All week you remember that? That's interesting.
It was the last thing you said.
I don't remember what I ate today. You know how many things I said from last Tuesday until now? Don't you see I don't have a voice? I cough. I want to thank you very much. Next Tuesday, please try to be on time. There's a lot of people who came an hour late. Chaval, I know you know the lectures are long and it's hard for you to sit. But the hour you lose between 8:30 and 9:30 until you get here, it's 60,000 mitzvot.
So whoever is late next time, they're going to get violation.
Violation. You be the policeman, give the tickets.
Sure.
I bring a credit card machine. You go, $52. Fine. Everyone who comes late. Very good. Baruch Adonai l'olam. Amen.